So let me introduce Tokyo.
And congrats here.
And congrats here. In his huge schedule, because he has master class today in Catholic University. Tomorrow in our facilities you will have another master class and two more master classes in Catholic University.
And a lot of stuff on the side like this.
But we called him and yeah. He is here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So I think I would like to run this, let's call it driven by your questions rather than me lecture. We have an agenda. I'm going to present some ideas to you, you know, like how to quantify all the values and things like that. But still, we could, you can drive me and I can pick subjects. So while we're warming up here, you see, that's my friend Martin. You think I'm joking? No. So he used to lecture at my Unitarian Church in Los Angeles when I was a child, 10 years old. And then next time I saw him, he was receiving Nobel Peace Prize in Oslo with his wife. That's what we do in Oslo. We give Nobel Peace Prizes to irritate the Chinese. Our favorite habit. And then my wife and I were attending his Nobel lecture, and then he snuck out the back afterwards, as VIPs do, and nobody else had figured it out except us. So, funny little scene, but my wife and I are in back of the presentation, the university aula it's called, and there's Martin and his wife getting into their car, and they look around, looking for the crowd, and all they see is us. So we wave to them, and they wave to us. And then he goes off and gets himself shot. Very shortly thereafter. So it's dangerous to wave to me, as my conclusion, cause and effect. Actually, Nikita Khrushchev once came to Oslo, and he was down at the harbor, and I was out there in the crowd and waving. And so then he went back and he was put out of power. So again, proof that waving to me, okay, wave, is dangerous. Anyway. So there's my friend Al, you see. I was 14 years old when he died, so in theory I could have met him, but I wasn't in the right part of the country. I was in California, he was in Princeton, and I don't know, he didn't ask to meet me for some strange reason. So. But I got to know him later. So here's a quiz question. There's a famous saying, things should be as simple as possible. Sounds good. But no simpler. You heard it before?
Yeah.
Who said that? Careful, trick question. Who said that?
Einstein.
Yeah, this is the joke. Everybody thinks Einstein said it, right? So I published that in the book, 1988. Principles of Software Engineering Management, actually the foundation for Agile book, if you want to know. I published it. Sounded good to me. I wrote Einstein's Principle. And then one young man I met in Texas came up to me and said, can you give me the source of this? You know, where and when did he say it? I said, no, everybody knows he said it, right? No, not so simple. This young man had been to Princeton, and some of his professors were friends of Einstein, just to give you some background. So, but he said, I think I know where we can prove it. There is a book written about Einstein, something is, it had a title, I forget the exact title, but it was something about God doesn't do things by chance. God has a purpose, something like that. And that was one of the things Einstein has said. And we drove to the bookstore in Austin, Texas. I bought the book. I read the book at the conference, and I couldn't find what he had said was there. I went back and said, it's not there. Oh, thought it was. Ah, well, I will talk to my professor friend who knew Einstein. Okay, and he did. Came back and said, yes, Einstein said this in an interview in Newsweek, 17th of May, 19, I forget the exact date, 52, something like that. But we've never been able to get a copy of that. However, I have found in the internet some interviews in Time magazine about that date Time, Newsweek, same organization, which he speaks about these things. This I've actually published in my new book, Value Planning, which you all get a free copy of. Okay. So here, I'm probably going to refer to it many times, okay? tinyurl.com. Okay, Value Plan. One word, okay? Go get your free copy. And some Einstein quotes, things like that, okay? By the way, see? Where have I seen that word value before? Oh, inspired by technology, driven by value. Oh, so that's why I'm here. Somebody values value. Okay. Now, then I went on a search. Turns out there's a book called Einstein Quotations by editor Alice Kalypris. And she has had access for many years to all of Einstein's private files at Princeton. So, can't get a better source. So I asked Alice, and she smiles, and she said, no, look in the chapter in my book, it said, things that people think Einstein said, which we cannot prove he said. Not that he didn't say, but we cannot prove that he said. It's in there. Everybody's always, so she's, the world authority on quotation says, she can't prove it. So we went on a hunt, friends of mine and I, and we found a lecture from on the internet from Cambridge, 1931. By Einstein, and he got very close, but not exact. That's the best we have. Then I was reading a book called by Marvin Minsky. Anybody ever heard that name, Marvin Minsky? Artificial Intelligence, MIT. And he wrote a wonderful book, something about Society of Mankind, something like that. Not exact title, but close enough. And I had bought it 10 years earlier, read a little bit, but I picked it up again and started reading it. Bingo. Albert Einstein. Things should be as simple as possible, but no simpler. And I couldn't resist. So, because at this point you wonder, is Marvin Minsky still alive? I mean, he's old as Einstein practically, right? Einstein died in 54 or 2 or whatever it was, okay? So, but I dig up in the university thing and there's Marvin Minsky's email. So I fire off an email and said, Marvin, do you realize that nobody can prove that Einstein said this, it's in your book. He said, by the way, I have the same problem. It's in my book too. And I got a wonderful email back. In fact, just for fun, I think I can, I have a whole section on this if anybody's interested, they can have it. But in my office, I have a fun little section called Quotations, where I save interesting quotations, including friend Einstein, and let's see, what is the Einstein quotation, and here's the simplicity quotation. So that's all my stuff about that. If anybody wants the first-hand stuff, why would you? I'm just having a bit of fun to warm up the audience, right? This is my joke before I hold the talk, right? Let's see, Minsky, 2010, and from Marvin Minsky. There we go. So this is the reply I got back. Okay. And to summarize, he said, well, is it here, the Jerusalem? Yeah. So he had written his book and he went to Jerusalem. Well, Jerusalem is the place that wanted to name Einstein first president of Israel, but he wouldn't have it, so Golda Meir got the job, you know. He was too smart to go into politics, especially in Israel. Yeah? What a crazy place. Almost crazier than Ukraine, right? Almost. But so as soon as he landed in the plane, they said, ah, you wrote an Einstein quotation. We are very interested in Einstein. And can you prove where it came from? And he said, proof where it came from? Everybody knows. He said, no, no, we can't find where it came from. And he realized that he could not prove it. So he realized 10 years before I told him. But he said, here's, now, I had known Einstein when I was in Princeton, 1950 to 54, and perhaps heard him say that, or something like that. I could have made a mistake because I had trouble understanding his very foreign accent. To which Alice replied, wow, he's a very humble man. He could have claimed he was the source who knew it was true. But he just said, Einstein had the very heavy German accent and you couldn't be sure what he was saying. So,
that's true.
So next time you see that, because it pops up in the books and in the Corfu lecture, every time I'm going to get you. So I send him a little bit, can you prove that? Okay.
Oh, well.
Yeah, Society of Mind is the correct title of it. So then we have my friend Indira there. Yeah, you don't think so? When in the time of Indira Gandhi, when she was prime minister, I was landing in New York and the man sitting next to me happened to be a personal assistant to Birla. Now, you may have not have heard of Birla, but they are a big empire, industrial empire, as big as Tata. You've heard of Tata Consultancy Services, right? Both Birla and Tata were thinking of starting in the computer business, like Ukraine. Same reason. Good people, not so high costs, foreign market, same thing. So the guy on the airplane said to me, Tom, would you come and advise us in India about how to start in the computer market? I said, well, why not? So as we got closer to the deal, they said, we have one little problem. We can't pay you. to be more specific, we can't pay you in foreign currency, except if we got personal permission of Indira Gandhi, which we could do. One of the guys I was working with was doing an IT app for the Prime Minister. So they knew her. They know everybody knows everybody in that little oligarchy. So, but we have a better deal. You and your wife come to India at our expense and live like Maharajas for about a month, and you hold a few lectures. How's that for a deal? My wife said, that's a good deal. Let's go. We knew we were living like royalty because next door to us at the Taj Mahal Hotel, owned by Tata, flying in by Air India, owned by Tata, right, were the present King and Queen of Norway, right next door to us. Then we knew we were living like royalty, literally. So we lived a good life and we didn't earn any money, but Tata, what happened was Birla introduced me to Tata, to F.C. Kohli, who was the chairman emeritus. I hope he's still alive, I didn't see him since 2005. And they said, we're going to form a company and we have this high skill, low cost situation which we need to exploit to help the economy of India. And they ran me around everywhere in India talking to everybody, talking. After a while, I got the big idea. The big idea was they never ever mentioned quality. They always mentioned low cost of people, high skill. True. So I went to them and said, you know, you're going to fail. I said, why? Because you're forgetting one thing. Nobody is going to buy your low cost if they fear they would fail and lose their job. Not going to happen. Too dodgy. You have to have quality not merely equal to, say, your American competitors. You have to have quality which is clearly superior, no doubt, five times better. Then maybe they will pay you. Same prices for the Americans. You don't even have to be cheaper. And they thought about it for a while. And they said, you're right. It's logical. We had the model of the Japanese who started with low quality and went to high quality paradigm. So, but they had never thought of that. Okay. So what did they do? They pulled a trick, which I was related to or associated with. How many people here have heard of CMM, Capability Maturity Model? Okay, enough people that will tell this silly story there too. By the way, if you want the slides I might use, we could use the ones from my lecture. They're here. On our website, guild.com, and you go to resources in guild.com, I'd like you to know the site, to downloads, and then in downloads, you'll find a thing called slides. Then you get a set of slides which I might open up depending on the questions, but slides about value and things like that.
Okay. But we go to a little section called pictures, and in pictures I have something called bragging rights. Bragging rights, see? And in that we have, this one will be good enough. So you're looking at a picture of Ron Reedus. You will find him today as a consultant at stt.com. Yeah. Quite a guy. There's his boss, Watts Humphrey, who was chief of IBM software, really, for many years. But Watts, a good friend of mine, he wrote a foreword to my book, Software Inspection. He went over to Carnegie Mellon University, really US Department of Defense. And with the objective to make all the defense suppliers, Raytheon, Boeing, better at IT and software. And he said, fine, we will use some of the methods we developed at IBM that have succeeded. And he picked the method of CMM, Capability Maturity Model. And basically said, if Department of Defense says, we will not buy from you unless you're at level 3, then everybody will try to get to level 3. We will force it. Because the marketing guys will say, you have to get to level 3 whether you like it or not, otherwise you're fired. We have no business for you. What a powerful mechanism. That really woke them up. So they all tried to get to level 3, or actually 2 and then 3. The Americans, most all of them, had actually great problems getting from level 1, which is chaos and the devil, anarchy, to level 2 at all. And it took years before many of them could get to level 3. But the Indians, I saw a catalog from, it's called NASCOM, the Association of Suppliers and Contractors in India, hundreds of them. Every one of them says, we are at level 4 or level 5. Yeah. This was the trick they pulled to convince the Americans that obviously we have superior contract equality because we are at level 5. You are struggling to get to level 2. Maybe you should hire us. There's just one little problem, and maybe you in Ukraine can guess what it is.
They were not.
Definition of
how about corruption? Here, you are an examiner, right? Somebody comes to you and said, if you give us level 5, we'll give you $5 million. Take your bank account cash. You know the deal. I am recently dealing with a very large Indian business who remained nameless in London for very large airport projects. And it was total catastrophe. They couldn't do anything. You know, millions of bugs, could not deliver software. But they were at level 5. What does that mean? Well, it means that once a little group in India got certified at 5, maybe by bribery, but nobody else learned anything. Okay, so you've got to be careful. But it worked anyway for Tata, because, by the way, Tata is ethical corporation compared to most other Indian corporations. Like they give their, they're like Bosch and Germany. They give their profits to charity and try to be a good member of society. Nice, maybe you. Yeah. Okay, so, okay, now this is, believe it or not, related to our subject today, quantification. Okay, so when I was 25 years old, I read something in a Norwegian newspaper, Words from the Lord. Kelvin. Lord Kelvin, I know you thought it was another word. And Lord Kelvin said, 1893, you have heard of the Kelvin scale of measure, of course, right? If you think you know something about a subject, try to put a number on it. Try to measure it, which is different from putting a number on it. If you can do this, maybe you know something about your subject. Wonderful formulation, maybe you know something. But if you cannot put a number on it and measure it, you should admit to yourself that your knowledge is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. Wow. Well, I was 25. You know what? That changed my life. I'm even hoping that by saying it, I might change your life a little bit. I know it changed my life. I suddenly looked at software with different eyes. You know, for example, there was a NATO Science Council conference called Software Engineering. 1968 and 1969. That's where the name software engineering came from, as it turns out. And they had a whole discussion group about portability of software. We already had, you know, new underlying platforms of hardware, and we had to keep the COBOL and Fortran programs going. So we had portability problems very early. And there's a big discussion about portability amongst top experts in the world, you know, the best professors in this country. But nobody even mentioned that portability might be quantified. Yeah, sign of the time. We still have this problem. People talk about the name, but they don't quantify it. They talk about security, but they don't quantify it. They talk about usability, but they don't quantify it. Even at this conference, we had a lot of talk about usability without quantification. Okay, still is in this. Yeah, so as a result of this challenge, that was 1965 to 69. By 1976, I coined a term, software metrics, which is now widely taught at universities. So I'm the father of software metrics. I have many strange titles. Grandfather of Agile is my favorite. We'll get into that later. But 1976, I published a whole book on software metrics, half of it theoretical. How would you quantify portability? Half of it practical, what people were really doing in the industry. Okay, because lots of people were doing things, but it was, we didn't have internet. So you almost had to know these people personally from being at a conference to gather the data to put in the book. Today you can research it on the internet. But I was going to a lot of conferences. They're good places to meet interesting people. Right? So anyway, about 1980, I met Ron Radis at a conference in England, and I held my usual talk that I held everywhere, including here, you should quantify quality. And he thought, and we bumped into each other in Oxford Street during the conference, but that's where tourists go, right? That's where your wife would bring you if you went to London, Oxford Street. Yeah. And he said, Tom, I have decided I want to invite you to come to IBM and convince my team, his team was inventing CMM, and convince my team that they should quantify quality. So I came, spent one day, did my best, and later he published in IBM System Journal, IBM has adopted as formal policy, quality will be quantified. Okay, not just one. Okay. What I didn't know was that when he designed CMM, he said level 4, that is quantification of quality primarily. That's that stage of maturity. The level 1 is chaos and anarchy, right? Unstable system, anything could happen. Level 2 is you're getting Deming's plan, do, study, act, stability of system. So that, in level 3, when you start injecting changes, you can see cause and effect. Because you have a stable system, therefore the cause must be the reason for the effect. So three was actually mainly based on a thing called inspections, software inspections. I told you I wrote a book on that in 1993, but Ron more recently wrote a book on inspections himself, because he is in fact the co-father with Michael Fagan of inspections. Okay. But I not only try to be very generous with my time in Ukraine, I have a few other charities. One of them is Mother Teresa. I have on many occasions actually met, she's not here, but she could have been, right? And I meet her, and every time I meet her, I write out a check, an American check. You know why? Because I collect autographs, and you get the check back with M. Teresa. I know it is. Seriously. Oh, I'd love to have a signed book by Einstein. Anybody got one of those? You want to give me a gift? Give me a signed book by Einstein. Yes, I know. Anyway, we're pushing 19. So, Mother Teresa, one charity. Another charity is the U.S. Department of Defense. Strange charity, right? You don't think of them as a charity, but really they're basket case. So once they said, Tom, we need your help very badly because we are wasting $20 billion a year on IT. And I said, well, I know I can help you. You know I can help you. But my God, just think of the bureaucracy of signing a contract for a one-man show for U.S. Department of Defense. It's not going to happen. There's only one way it's going to happen. I have to give away my time and just fly in and do it. No contract. Mm-hmm. And that's when I became a volunteer. Now, it turns out that's old American tradition. The people kept asking, can he really do this? And they said, it's almost in the Constitution. That's how Paul Revere and George Washington, all these guys, did the revolution. Your Maidan revolution, anybody paid to get shot? Volunteers. Right? So volunteering for the nation is actually a nice thing. And I volunteering to sit in an office talking like this is a lot better than sitting, getting shelled by Russian grenades or something like that. You see, so it's actually a nice military job. So I started volunteering for the military. Now, once I was already, have you ever seen an old film, it's called Dr. Strangelove? Think of the man sitting on top of the rocket going, you know, the crazy general, that one. Okay, that was filmed at Strategic Air Command in Omaha, Nebraska, where they have deep bunkers, you know, so the Russian rockets can't get them. And that's where they run the Strategic Air Command, which sends the atomic weapons towards Kiev, probably. Luckily, we didn't have to do it. Okay. Anyway, I was there, and they of course, they have CMM, Capability Maturity Model. So while I was in between my other work there, for which I got a glorious award from the general, actually Rear Admiral J.C., wait for it, think James Bond, Rear Admiral J.C. Moneypenny. And if you think I'm joking, I've got it in my computer. Moneypenny. Award for service to the nation. You know, free, and they're free. Everybody else is trying to get lots of money from them. I said, no. The goodness of my heart, when they helped my country defend itself against, you know, Ukraine. Okay. So, but I was reading, so I was thumbing through these big, thick manuals of CMM, and I come to level four. And level four, everything I read is like from my books, what I said. It's me. Wow, somebody stole my stuff. And then I realized I had taught all this to Ron, and Ron had written all this. So a few months later, we're going to a defense conference where I'm keynoting and Watts Humphrey is keynoting in Salt Lake City. They have an annual conference. And Ron is there. Now, we wouldn't recognize, this is 20 years later almost, right? And we wouldn't recognize each other, right? Gray hair, beard, glasses, but we have these big badges on, so that helps. Hey, Ron, Tom, you know, so. Ron, confirm or deny, I am level four. I didn't know it until then. Of course, Tom. Well, thank you. Nice to know. You never told me. No, everybody knows, except me. I said, I would be stupid if I walked away from that without getting proof and evidence. One of the concepts I'd like to teach you today about estimation. Evidence. So, you see the evidence. Back of his business card, write it down, Ron. Sign it. Before you die tomorrow and nobody can say that Tom invented CMM level four. double check it and confirm it. I walked up to Watts later and I said, Ron just signed this document saying I'm level four. And he's the big boss and director of all this stuff at Carnegie Mellon. And he said, of course, Tom, we all know this. So that I didn't get him. He's not the kind of man you get to sign. It's like, you know, President Obama, would you sign this for me? He's too big a guy. So, but he's a nice guy. He is all the good. Okay, so maybe you connected the dots. When Indira Gandhi said, let's go IT, and Gil said, let's do quality, they chose CMM, which I partly invented. Isn't that fun? It's fun for me anyway. So, now, that's, let's see, any other friends here? That's my friend Marie, of course, right? She's good at curing things. That's a joke, sort of. And that must be Igor. Helicopter.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I didn't meet him yet. Uh-huh. I know that face, but I can't, too early in the morning to put it
up.
Sasha. Yeah, the famous Russian scientist. Right, I didn't meet him either. There was a point where I refused to go to the Soviet Union at all in protest against Stalin and everything, and actually putting some of my friends in jail and not letting them out. And I did it publicly. Some of you appreciate that. Okay, made a very point. I was constantly getting invited by KGB to come and do things in Soviet Union. It didn't say KGB, it just said IT people who'd like your advice. I was speaking with a certain founder of your company yesterday, who's a politician these days, and he said, oh, wait a minute, I have to take a break. He comes back with a card where it says U.S. Embassy. And he said to me, ah, CIA, they think they can fool me. I know CIA when I see it. Same thing. But this KGB or CIA. So, okay. Now, I've had my fun for a while. It's only 11:06. By the way, I failed to tell you, I believe we should take a break every hour. So, but that would be about 11:30, wouldn't it? So somebody set an alarm for 11:30, please. Yeah. And then we're going to take a 10-minute break then. But before that, let's get started. So now, I've sort of introduced myself a little bit. What is the burning question you'd like to ask and get a deep, intelligent, helpful answer, if I can do it? That's the question. What is the question?
How to make strategy work.
How to make strategy work.
Okay.
We can do that.
Simple question.
Okay. Number one. How make strategy work. Okay. Now, we can take first we will have to have a good definition of work. Okay, this is an ambiguous word. It could mean, you know, it's working, the process is going, we're writing the code, right? But that's not a good definition. Okay, so I have a different definition. A strategy works when it delivers value.
Okay.
And we can then add planned value as opposed to negative unplanned value or other values. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a good definition. Now we're on topic suddenly. Okay. Now that means that you have to define value so that it can be tested. Mm-hmm. Is it delivered? Is it not? If the value is a variable, like improved user friendliness or security, then you not only have to test it, you have to measure it. Mm-hmm. In other words, if it said we want 99% security, you have to measure you have reached 99%. And you can do that by forms of testing, but this is not testing, is the function there or is that not, conventional software testing. This is testing to measure that the values are delivered, not unknown in all engineering and science. Okay, but almost unknown for software people, strangely enough. Okay. But you all have degrees in science, engineering. How many people just have a degree in computer science? So you should have taken an engineering degree, really. But well, I hope your computer science degree was a good one. Learning measurements and scientific, real science and real engineering. But the computer science I see is a lot of programming bullshit stuff and not really science at all. So, but it's even software engineering really isn't engineering, it's just programming. We have a little problem there. We've adopted the terms but not the content. Hi.
Nothing more important.
By the way, just a general, my wife claims that I don't hear everything she says and I should get a hearing aid. And there may be some truth in it, so can you just speak up? Two things. You get to me and the other people at the same time. Everybody just speak up to me. Shout. Dude, stand up is good. Right in my...
I believe.
My God.
I forgot what I believe.
I believe there is one important word we all want to get.
And it is?
Sustainable.
Sustainable!
Sustainable okay. Delivery of land value.
Okay.
In fact, we can deliver value.
Okay.
We can do it sustainably.
I like that.
Thank you.
Because what does it help if the moment you deliver it, you have 99%, but the next 10 years you have only 10%?
It
has, absolutely correct, it was implied, I mean, of course it has to be sustainable, but the problem is if you don't say that and do something about it, people might just cheat a little bit to get through the exam. Mm-hmm. You know, I interviewed a lot of people and I discovered something, say, well, what did you learn? Oh, chemical engineering. So I ask a problem about chemical engineering, and they can't answer the simplest problems. And I said, but you have a degree in chemical engineering. Yeah, but I forgot everything after the exam. You see? So, in other words, their knowledge was not sustainable in some sense. But the idea of getting a degree is to get sustainable knowledge, I think. You know? Everything I do and teach and write about is sustainable knowledge. I believe it will all be valid in 5,000 years' time. And I'm not joking. We can talk about that later. A simple test. 2 + 2 = 4 5,000 years ago in Egyptian times, right? All my lifetime it's been 4. I think 2 + 2 will be 4 in 5,000 years' time. See, there are some classes of knowledge which are permanent, eternal, classical, long half-life, call it what you like. I have decided, when I was very young, about 25, I also made another decision to seek sustainable knowledge, not temporary fashion knowledge, like Scrum has a 15-minute stand-up meeting. I don't think in 5,000 years' time anybody will go or care. But they may care about the idea of feedback and learning. The plan to study ACT loop of Dr. Deming. I predict they will care very much about that, no matter what. So that's, I prefer that class of knowledge. Sustainable, okay. How to measure it? Okay. Now here's the thing. We can add how measure, but for me that's a, for the moment, separate question from how to make the strategy work. Mm-hmm. You see? So I take that as an independent question. I write it up as number 2. How to measure? No problem. Okay. How to make a strategy work.
How to predict, the last question.
Well, that's the third question. See? How to predict value for a strategy. That is a separate question. So estimation is a question, measurement is a question, and making sure the damn thing works in the real world is a different question. So I need to divide and answer them separately. Now, if I was to say, Tom, could you give the answer to all of them simultaneously? No problem. Read the book. That's everything I said. So you will discover if you read the book after this that I'm just telling you things that are in the book, more or less. So, okay. Even the quotations from Marvin Minsky are in the references to the book. Okay. And this stuff. Okay. So how to make a strategy work? Well, I have some opinions, but you have some opinions. So I invite the following comment. Here is my idea of how to make them work. Or here is the problem with making them work. Anybody like to try before I have a go? See if I can come up with something better than you are thinking about, if I'm lucky. My water disappeared, somebody cleaned it up, but I see some water, so I'm safe. Thank you, Bob. Okay, anybody want to offer, here's my opinion of the answer? Anybody want to offer opinion why it is difficult? If you know why it is difficult, you have a chance to invent something that gets around the difficulty, so you have solutions. Okay? If you already know how to do it, then share it with me. If it's something I don't know, then wow, I learned something today. I'll tell you if I learned something from you that I don't already know and haven't already written in the book. But that's the challenge. Can you teach me something? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Because I have 50-year head start on you. If you're equally smart or an equal rate, I still have 50 years before you. I started at IBM in 1958. I was 17 years old. Okay? So I have a head start. But you can try to go ahead of me. The tortoise and the hare, you know? I'm the tortoise, you're the hare. Okay, so solutions? Come on, don't be shy. I'm not going to jump on you if you suggest something stupid. Maybe the best you know.
Well, probably the answer is on the whiteboard already. Strategy, value, measures, and tests. In order to make a strategy work, we must identify what value to which consumers want to deliver.
By the way, my name is Tom, and your name is
Roman.
Roman, how do you do, Roman?
Good.
Yeah, I knew I'm going to have to deal with him all day, right? So, yeah. So I will say you are right. Part of the answer of making things work is the ability to measure that it is working or not. Because if you cannot measure if it's working or not, how can you make it work or prove that you made it work? So definitely part of the answer, okay? Quantification and measurement, part of the answer, but maybe not all of the answer, but a good start. Because so many people are completely missing this measurement, therefore they cannot make the strategies work or prove that they work. I mean, we can say we certainly have to start there. That's fundamental. That's basic. And it applies to everything in the universe, like Tesla cars and Apple watches and everything else. Not special for software. You have basic to science and engineering is measurement. Okay? And that's how engineers make things work. Mm-hmm. They measure.
Yep.
Sure. Okay. But anybody else have an additional insight or?
First of all, we have to define what does it mean value delivered by storage.
Yeah, right.
So
good. So let's see if I get a little. See, we have
is a nice
here. Step. We have to measure, but we have to, and we can put this up as almost the fourth question: how define a value
delivered by storage.
Yeah. So I call this specification. Mm-hmm. You will know it under different names, such as requirements specification defines a value. Setting management objectives defines a value. Okay, these kinds of things. But so this in itself is a problem, because if I said to you, define portability quantitatively, I'm suspecting most of you don't have an answer, right? Anybody say, I know how to do that. We have done it on our projects, portability. Mm-hmm. For our clients, so that when we build a system, but they change platforms, our system will still work. The client wanted it. I had a client, happened to be University of Oslo, 1968. They were building administrative systems, payroll and accounting, mm-hmm. outside contractor. Mm-hmm. But they realized that the university was going to put in any nice big computer they ever got as fast as possible. And it wasn't going to be a nice little administrative COBOL thing. It was going to be, you know, number crunching stuff. And it could be radically different. So they realized that the computer they're using could be swapped out and their applications wouldn't work. So when they contracted for the applications, they said it must be portable to any computer that the university would buy, the apps. Now I took one look at that and said, there's a little problem here. They've not quantified it. See? Now it turns out, if you don't quantify it, you can make anything in software portable if you rewrite the whole thing from scratch. Which might cost you, in other words, the portability actually means you're saving a bit because you've already done the work, so you just move it over. So if you have to rewrite from scratch, you're not saving anything. You have a zero portability, or worse, negative portability. So this sort of is the point. So I said, the problem here is this contract does not have a number in it. And they said, how do you do that? And I said, actually, I don't know, but we'll find out. That's my attitude there. So I then invented the portability metric. That was 68. This book came out in 76, so 10 years later it's in the book. It's also in some other books I can give you, like Competitive Engineering 2005. Remind me, I'll give you the link to that. Some of you already have it, hopefully, if you think about it. Some of you know. Okay. So I said, what about the following? Let's rewrite the contract. You say, we can't do that, we wrote it. No, you can pull out of it and say, if you don't rewrite it, we don't make the contract. okay. So I suggested that the contract should say there will be 95% portability. That's just the start. What does that mean? It means that we will never spend more than 5% of the original cost of porting. Simple.
Yeah.
And actually, I had invented the portability metric for software first time in history without realizing it. And but now wait a minute. By the way, a guarantee can be empty, not sustainable. Okay. So we added the following clause: the supplier undertakes to do the porting themselves, and we will pay up to 5% of the original cost for the porting, and the contractor will pay the rest. So if they had only 90% portability, we pay them for 5%. They have to lose money, all the ones they earned. So you know what happened? The moment they read that contract condition, they changed the programming language that we're planning to use so it was more portable, so they didn't lose money. And I saw the power of a metric in action before we'd even written the line of code. Nice story. I should just write that up someday. Maybe at this point, I should show you how to get the portability measure. So still busy answering the first question, right? But let's see. First, oh, there's a better way of doing what I just thought about. Excuse me a moment. Okay, so we go to the, you can do this now on your iPhone if you like, what I'm going to do. You go to the downloads section, okay, and then there's something called Guild Essentials. So this is the main stuff I like to communicate to people. Okay? And press the button. Yeah. Okay. But by the way, a static copy of my Valiant Planning book is there, if you want another way of finding it. You forget the link. But it's static because that link is dynamic. As I edit it, which I did in Odessa and on the airplane flying in here, it changes. I'm still editing chapter 7 to 10. But if you go down here, it says here, the end, it says CE stands for Competitive Engineering. That's my book, 2005. And it says scales of measure. Okay. Now, I'm going to bring that up. Okay. So then if you put portability in there, and it's a good idea to spell it correctly because this computer is not as smart as, for example, Google in PDFs. There we go. So first thing you have to see is quite interesting in itself. This is a map of traditional qualities that everybody's interested in. Here's the whole user friendliness area. Okay. So now here is an area called adaptability, which has a lot of things there, but one of them which we hit is called portability, which is adapting to a new platform. Got it? Yeah. So these are the qualities that occur in almost every software and IT project on level. So they're fairly standardized. Now there's something else here, okay? And if we go, I guess it's here, okay? So it says here, scale. The cost to transport a defined system from a defined initial environment, the university's old computer. The system is the accounting and payroll applications written by outside contractor, could be you, right? And to a defined target environment, the university's new computer. And the fun is, we don't know which one that is, but we know they will do it. They're just gonna, as soon as they get the money for a faster computer, the university will buy it. Okay, whatever it is. And it's not going to be very good in COBOL. It's going to be very good in those days, Fortran and things like that, right? Floating point computation. So it's not going to be very business friendly, this computer. Okay. using a defined means. Now notice the variables there. The means, you could do a complete rewrite manually from scratch. You could change things so it fit the new environment. You could use an automated tool, if you're lucky, to convert, you see, with different means. You could use an outside contractor to do it, you could do it yourself. So in other words, how portable it is will depend on the means you use. Obviously, a really good automated tool probably do it better than and cheaper than good people. Okay, but it might not be available. Another recognition here is that portability isn't what most people initially think it is, moving the code. You've got to move the data. You've got to move the operating system stuff. Okay, you've got to consider media like old diskettes on the old computer and new forms of storage on the new computer. Okay, and all that has to, and their formatting, right? So you have four different classes of porting to port a system. Almost everybody keeps on focusing on the code. We're still very narrow-minded about code programmers. Okay, the joke is they always forget data. We used to call it data processing. Data came before the processing, DP. Okay, so I just gave you the key to looking up how to quantify most of these. Now the nice thing about this is you may have something different, but I'll make you a bet. One of these will give you a pattern. It'll give you some ideas if you modify how to tackle the problem. So if you were to say, I give you some homework, tonight, read the chapter. Try to memorize it if you're good. At least you'll know what's in there. Next time you have to quantify something, you say, oh, that's like that portability thing. Not quite, but I'll look at it. Ah, if I modify it here, I can do it. So this is one method of how to quantify software qualities. Look it up in my book. Easy. I didn't have that method. Remember, I wrote the book. I used another method. It's called common sense and intelligence. Works very well. I just reasoned, well, 100% portability means no cost. 0% portability means you have to write the same. That's all I did. I said, so 50% means half cost. What does minus 50% mean? Minus 50% portability.
Additional cost.
Yeah, 50% additional cost compared to the real cost of port. That can happen too. Nice. Now, let me show you, in a way I'm actually answering question four, to be quite honest, right here, but then that's prelude to this anyway, and part of our syllabus. So let me teach you another method. So I've given you two methods. Look it up in my book. It'll solve 95% of your problems. Use your common sense and intelligence. You look smart, so that will deal with the other 5%. Okay. But there's another method. In fact, I say in one word, I can teach you how to always achieve quantification of inequality. And the word is?
Money. Money.
What's that word?
Money.
Money? Not at all. Plenty of rich people cannot solve this problem. People with the wealth of, say, Bill Gates, probably can't solve this problem. Money doesn't help. He has his money and Warren Buffett's money, total $100 billion or so to give away. I'm not sure he can solve these problems.
No, I'm not saying about having money.
Oh.
Calculating money.
No, so. No. Okay, so simple answer. I know where you're going. I'm just saying, no, forget it. I'll give you some reasoning, okay? If you take a close look in all of my book there, it's not about money at all. Portability is about effort and resources.
Okay, let's say
like work hours of people to port. But almost everything, so there's money and everything can be converted to money.
Let's say resources.
Resources, better.
Money is resources.
Yes, but here. Now this is the problem. Why I'm reacting so strongly, you might wonder. Okay. People don't know how to convert directly into portability or usability
but they know how about money measurement, so they use money because they don't know how to do it properly. As far as I'm concerned, money is a surrogate, a bad solution. It's a possible solution, but it's indirect. Now, if it's indirect, you cannot control it technologically. That's the problem. That's why I'm reacting. You have got to control, as Kant said, das Ding an sich, the thing in itself, the usability itself, the security itself. If you don't control it, as Volkswagen learned about trustworthiness, you lose big money. But the money is the consequence of the lying and cheating. The lying and cheating is the problem they need to control. Throwing money at it doesn't help. And measuring it money is too late. They already lost the money. They already set aside $8 billion just in the first days and another $10 billion, and maybe it's going to be a lot more. Okay. So my big advice to you is technologically, stick to technology. Let the accountants deal with the money. I'm quite serious. It's misleading. We need to get to the technology itself. We are tech, I'm speaking, I hope, mainly to technologists. Okay. And the bean counters will count the beans. They will see how much Volkswagen have lost. But the bean counters and accountants are not the one who caused the problem of lying about diesel emissions or are going to solve it. Okay. By the way, about a week ago, I was holding a class for British Computer Society in London. By the way, we have free courses in London. The next course, Startup Planning, 2 days, 10th and 11th of November. Mm-hmm. Want a trip to London? Actually, they're free if you're a British Computer Society member, and the bean counters got in there and said, if you're not a member, you have to pay £40 for the coffee we're going to give you. I couldn't stop it. Bureaucracy and bean counters got away. I love the free courses. It's really nice. Okay, so everybody can come. But so you have a choice. You can join British Computer Society for about £100 and go on three courses, and it's all paid off, the coffee. Anyway.
So what was the word?
Yeah, so the point was, we had a one-day course on managing value, sort of same as this. And we decided to do it not by lecturing at all, or not even by Gil telling funny stories. We decided to do it by practical work. So I pick a project. So I said to them, I'm going to give you a choice of two projects to work on today. One, Syrian refugee crisis. Solve it. Number two, Volkswagen's problem. They all chose the Volkswagen's problem. I have all the stuff where we're quantifying all the values of Volkswagen, like confidence and trust. I have it right there. Maybe I'll show it to you. Okay? So they spent the day quantifying Volkswagen's problem of trust, confidentiality, and lying, and coming up with strategies that they felt they could quantify would help Volkswagen. Okay? Hey, instead of just talking about it, why don't I just show you a little bit, fun there. Let's see, go to the browser, and there is the app. We hit part of the work. Okay. So here is one of the values, restitution, whatever that means. Now that's just the name of it. If we go to a definition of restitution, the scale of measure is number of actions of restitution taken divided by the number of failings identified by review. Okay, it might take you a while to parse it, but this is restitution is actions that Volkswagen takes to fix the problem. What did they do? They fired the CEO, right? They set aside $8 billion. They said, we will have an independent inquiry. I don't believe that, but it sounds good, right? So they already took six known actions of restitution in the first week. They decided to handle the problem, okay? But how many actions is Volkswagen going to have to take before everything's good again? My estimate is at least 100 in the next few years. Rough estimate. But it's not 7. And it's not 7 million. So I'm guessing it's a big number, much bigger than what they did in the first week. If you take 6 actions in 1 week and you have a 5 or 10 year problem, there's got to be more actions. So we are. Now this is a part of short term Volkswagen credibility.
In other words, they earn credibility by, sorry, fire the CEO, here's 8 million, we guarantee no Volkswagen user will lose, etc. We'll never lie again. I've got a feeling that I've told that 95% of Ukrainian politicians are all corrupt. At least one guy I was talking to, he was absolutely certain that was the case. I don't know how, he maybe knows 100 politicians. So I'm guessing they also all lie all the time. Like they have a poster that says, we are the anti-corruption party. I don't know. Let's hope. So, now, this is a tool built by my friend Richard Smith. We are planning to use this big time at the university. I just got formal permission to use the tool Wednesday, Thursday for exercises. And maybe we can play, we're playing with it a little bit now, just showing you what we did. But if we go, yeah, that's the parent, select. Actually, this is up in the clouds, so there could be delays that I don't intend, so I don't worry about it too much. That's the British Computer Society 25th. Oh, okay. Right again. Back to the table. So, anyway, long story short, we have a restitution objective, which is defined quantitatively, which may be well done or badly done. These are just students trying to do this first time. They don't take anything seriously. They're not ready to give advice to the new CEO of Volkswagen yet. But I'm sure the new Volkswagen of CEO has to go through this process somehow. Okay. And then they say, well, one restitution could be carbon offset. You sort of know what that is, right? Maybe you buy some carbon credits or you go electrical. My son, in the middle of this scandal, on this same Friday, my son was taking delivery of a car from Volkswagen. Pure electric. Imagine his previous car, and my previous car was a Volkswagen diesel. Mm-hmm. They cheated me too. They polluted my children and grandchildren. I'm angry. This was a trusted brand. We thought we could believe in them. But what do you expect? I mean, who invented the first Volkswagen? Porsche. Under which political regime? The Nazis. What do you expect? Deep roots. Okay. So there's another idea, product recall, right? Well, bring back the cars. We'll fix it. Okay. By the way, if you want to learn anything about what is carbon offsetting, you just push a little button. It says here, the gist of it, rough idea, buy carbon credits equal or greater to the amount of excess of whatever, blah, blah, blah. Okay? And then they didn't go much deeper, it says the student exercise. Okay? So, we're back to the table. Now, my students have also estimated that we need to go from 0 to 100, okay? They estimate if we do this, we get 10. That means we get 1/10 of the way. This is an estimate of the effect of that design or strategy. You could be wrong. Maybe if we do that strategy, we get only 3. Maybe we get 30. Maybe nobody knows. Maybe nobody can know because there are unknowns that are going to happen in the future, going to affect the whole thing, and nobody can know. Okay? A law might change. A war might start. A plane might get shot out of the sky. You never know. Nobody knows. Okay? But just because nobody knows doesn't mean that somebody cannot estimate roughly. Because if they estimate, for example, 0 for the strategy. We will not move forward towards our goal. We will not move towards our value. If they estimate 0, what does that mean, logically? I call this design logic. What do they mean? What does it mean, 0?
No influence.
Pardon?
No influence.
No, I'm saying the word, I'm not hearing quite the...
No efforts.
Effort.
No effort, sorry. No actions. No movement.
Yes, right.
No progress, maybe.
Yeah, I think he's saying that. But yeah, so zero means we do not expect to move anywhere. It means the strategy is worthless. It means we should throw away the strategy, because why waste time and money on it if it's doing nothing for our value? This is design logic. It's amazing how many people grab designs that sound hot. I mean, this sounds good, carbon offsetting. We do have a little emissions problem here, you know? It's popular to do carbon offsetting. Norwegian government, instead of solving their problem in Norway, has lots of money, so they buy carbon offsets in rainforests in Brazil, making a lot of environmentalists pretty angry. They're not solving the problem in Norway. You know? But that's one of the big political tricks, is buy solutions elsewhere, don't solve your own problems. Okay? Yeah. But they do estimate better than zero. Therefore, and they estimate something which happens to be 10% of the way, so I wouldn't throw it away yet. Now, if I find something cheaper and faster, which gets me 99% of the way, I'd prefer that one. But I don't have it yet. So I have to keep, maybe I have to have 10, which get me each 10% of the way, thus getting me to 100% of the way. Maybe I need 10. Sometimes the only way to solve the problem is a large number of ideas. There is no one big idea at all, okay? How are we going to get rid of corruption in Ukraine? How many different strategies can you imagine? How effective will each strategy be? We can do this as an exercise, planning a removal of corruption in Ukraine. Right? I know a man is very interested in that. Yes?
We already missed the break time.
What?
We already missed the break time. It's 11:45.
Thank you very much. Somebody was supposed to say the alarm went at 11:30 and they totally failed, so you don't understand numbers very well. I'll have to find something better than a number, like setting my own alarm, taking responsibility myself. I obviously cannot delegate to you. But I can give you a break now for 10 minutes.
In Ukraine we say that if more than one person is responsible for something, that no one is responsible for
Mr. Nobody, that's right. Okay, so 10 minute break, and I'm going to now set my own 10 minute break alarm. I trust no one. By the way, I need a computer expert who can tell me why my email won't go out from your web service. Not now, but next break. Anybody say I can crack that in an instant, you know?
Can you list my next break?
Well, I can't, because I was trying to send something to Roman and it doesn't go.
Well,
yeah. I don't know. I can give you a hint. I'm on Alex Coffee and
it's
not working.
Alex's a pilot.
There's the connection doctor.
Tom, it's an example of how we have security for security and security not for value.
Yes, I believe it. Not user friendly. Okay. I will be sending some things I discussed with Roman in the theater. Okay, so we go back here. Okay, may I have your silence, if not your attention? Because the people who want to pay attention are disturbed by your noise and talking in the background. Did I make myself clear? I don't have to quantify it. Okay. So, would somebody please, hey Siri. Please set an alarm for 1 hour.
She did it.
12:56. I can trust Siri. I cannot trust you. Siri's a nice lady. Okay. So, by the way, we are looking at part of the answer, how to make a strategy work. Okay? So, first thing is, any strategies here must work in the sense of moving us towards our goal. Right? If they do not move us, then you can't make them work, in a sense. We have declared in advance, it will, does not seem to have any movement, so don't do it. A negative effect, get rid of it quick before it destroys any good you do. Okay? You have to have positive effect to adopt a strategy at all. Rule one. Now, if the positive effect is of the 100% of the weight of the goal you need is 0.00000095. Also, equivalent to zero in practice. Worthless. Don't do it. So, if, in other words, you need not just an a positive effect, you need a good enough, whatever that means, positive effect. Okay? So that's to say, order of magnitude 5 to 10% might be good enough for some purposes, although normally I'm looking for 30% or more, third of the way, for most purposes. Okay? And if I have one strategy that promises to get me 90% of the way, not only is that a good thing, but I will do that one first. Why will I do the 90% before the 30% and 10%?
It's the fastest way.
Might be. It's not quite what I was fishing for, but that's correct.
Close it for our goals.
What if you think it will give you 90%, but it only gives you 80? You're still way ahead of the 30, which might only be 10. In other words, the risk of getting very, very bad results is probably somewhat less with a big promise that gets a little worse than a little promise that gets a lot worse. Okay? So just, in other words, starting with the big one is generally a good idea. I didn't say always. For example, if the big one costs 100 times more than one which is rated at 50% of the way, which one do you now choose? You'd be stupid to choose the 90% at 100 times the cost. So that is why we are evaluating costs. Nobody's done anything there, I think. And why we look at the performance to cost ratio. Because in general, and I say in general meaning there are exceptions, in general, it's a good idea to choose the strategy with the best value for money, or value for time spent, or something, value for resources. Okay, so there's two very powerful ideas. In fact, they're the dominant ideas of this session here, okay? Number one, everything begins with some attempt to quantify the value. If you don't have that, you have nothing. You cannot even think about a design or a solution logically. Thinking is relative to the goal, the target, the objective, the requirement. Completely relative, not only to something like how much, but there's another one hidden here for the moment, but it's in the method, when. Okay? If Volkswagen has 10 years to solve the problem, that's one thing. But what if they say, no, European Commission has decided that Volkswagen cannot sell any cars in Europe unless they solve this problem in 3 months? Different problem. Totally different architecture may be necessary to solve the problem within 3 months rather than 10 years. Okay? So the timing dramatically changes the architecture or solution you choose. Some solutions can work in the short term and some cannot, is the simple reasoning behind that. So you have to look at two dimensions at least. Actually, there are, in practice, more like 5 to 10 dimensions, but we'll get to that later. But the first dimension is how much value do we want? And the second critical dimension is when do we want it? I'll give you a hint about the other dimensions. Where do we want it? Ukraine or US? For whom do we want it? Volkswagen drivers or Volkswagen dealers? Under what conditions do we want it? Cars being returned for service, or we go to the... Need I go on and on to show you there are many dimensions of the problem? Okay. We call these dimensions scale parameters. Okay, that's the technical term. And I showed you them, you know, like moving from a defined environment to another environment using defined means. Those are three scale parameters. Okay? Now, scale parameters are an interesting tool because they help us decompose the problem so that the high value things can be extracted and done first. This, I'm now talking, believe it or not, agile, but guilds agile, value agile, not coding agile, you see? So in good agile in the sense of not big bang, small steps, right? That's all I mean by the word agile. But value agile, we like to say that the if we can subdivide the strategy and the requirements so that we can very quickly do something of very high value, and we do it, and it's pretty good. And then next week we look for something else in the sub-strategies and in the sub-goals, a very high value, and we do it next week. If you do that, what happens? Well, in extremely simple terms, we have a little 80-20 rule, is a popular way of saying it. 20% of the project time, we get 80% of the value. Simply by selecting, doing the high value things first. That is known as prioritization. And later in my deeper teachings, we will talk about dynamic prioritization, which means on the 50th step, you do not do the 50th step you planned, because you will never plan 50 steps ahead. No chess player would ever do anything so dumb. You have to look at the situation at step 50, how much resources you have left, used, how much you have left. I only have 3 weeks before the deadline. I only have $1,000 of the money. I only have one man left on the project. I have got to do something that I can do with one person for $1,000 in whatever time remaining. And that is the architecture. I have to select the architecture based on the instantaneous conditions. Otherwise, I'm late, I'm over budget, and I don't have the people to do it, and nothing will get done. It doesn't matter if there's some really good architecture that would take $100,000 and 1 year and 10 people. I don't have them. Therefore, my architecture must be selected with what I really have. What's new? Don't you really have to choose the house you will live in, the vacation you will take, according to the time you are given to take the vacation, the money you have left to do it? Right now. Not what you thought you would have a year ago. Oh, we had to use more for the house, we have less for the vacation. You can always take up a loan, but that's another problem. What, 30% interest? Credit cards? That's what they do in Britain. Amazing how many people have incredibly large credit card loans, finance their style of life. You don't, you're not so stupid, right? No. My credit cards, zero. Sorry. I've learned to live within my needs, whatever they are.
0%?
Pardon?
0%.
0%?
1-0.
No. I have zero debt on any credit card. I have credit cards. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I just need a lot of money in a hurry in a certain situation. They only accept credit cards, not debit cards. I spend it, but I pay it off right away. I don't incur the debt. The interest is ridiculous. It's a trap for the stupid. But you're all smart people, so you would never. Okay. So yeah. Okay. So we're beginning to answer the question. I'm going to reiterate again. You have to do the requirement, the value, very clearly. Only then can you reason about the solutions. Like, it's a good idea, it's a bad idea, we should do it first. That's reasoning. Okay? But the reasoning is theoretical. All estimates. Will I be alive tomorrow? I think so. Is it true? We'll find out. So, estimates are of such a nature that they are not for sure, generally speaking. Okay? But that doesn't mean we don't estimate, because estimation is a very useful tool. You know, we may be a little bit wrong, but if we are largely right that the 90% things are big and the 1% things are small, so we need only order of magnitude. That's an engineering paradigm. Order of magnitude is fine. It's all you can realistically expect to get. Got it? Then we can still make good decisions. Choose the 90% instead of the 1%. If you have no numbers, you cannot make that choice. You will often make the 1% choice without realizing it, because people are over-optimistic and have been sold that if you only do lean, everything will be great in your corporation. But is that a 1% or a 90% solution to your problem? Well, we didn't actually define our problem. Then it's impossible to know about lean. But managers do that all over the world, too. They grab the latest fashion, say lean, heard from some good salesman that if you paid that consultant a lot, they'd help the whole corporation do lean, and lean sounds good because it means like lower costs, right? That must be good, okay? And they spend years and years and they misapply it, and the consultancy corporation like Accenture sucks them dry for money and finally gets kicked out, but it's too late, they run away with the money. This is a new mafia. You think your corruption is bad, try Accenture stealing money from people all over the world. They've been caught by the British government with big corruption in Britain. They're doing the same in Norway, caught with gigantic IT projects, running 7 times over cost, 5 years over cost, delivering nothing. That's the new mafia. Much better than drugs, prostitution, crime, robbing banks. Yeah. I'm sure you are not such a mafia part of it, right? But I can't be absolutely sure. You would deny it if I asked. I have no point in asking. That's an important okay. Now, okay, so we have estimates. Now, estimates guide us into doing something. Me, I'm an action guy. Next week, I want to do something. And I mean next week. I don't mean next month or next quarter. And somebody said, but it will take at least a month. I said, then you must decompose to a week. They said, I don't know how to decompose. I said, okay, two options. I will challenge you to use your intelligence and common sense and find a week, or I will teach you. You know, your choice. You can admit that you're so stupid you can't figure it out, or you can try. I found half of everybody, if they have that challenge, they will find a way. They have to be seriously challenged, but they will find a way. Half of people give up, don't know how to decompose, for example, a solution. So there's another big area. In the value planning book, I have 10 subchapters on decomposition. I go in depth about how to decompose, okay? But what I learned is, initially, nobody taught me. Actually, one guy did. His name was René. Can anybody guess the last name?
Descartes.
Who, what?
Descartes.
It's yeah, exactly. My hero. Why isn't René on the wall here?
He's my hero.
Yeah. Yeah. So he was the master of tackling complex problems through decomposition, known as Cartesian analysis. Okay. So, and I did as a young in Norway at university. They have a strange 100-year-old tradition. You must spend 1 year studying philosophy and pass the philosophy examination, Examen Philosophicum, it's called in Latin, before you can take any other university examination. Philosophy is a prerequisite, any university study. It's a change, different, like a business school would not necessarily require that today, but the university also would require it for law, history, medicine, and things like that. So I had to learn philosophy and Descartes, whether I liked it or not, if I wanted to do anything else at the university. But, and I'm looking back, it's a very good idea, very powerful. Okay, but that's where the, no, okay. So, but I had no other teacher, and it really, all I learned was you should decompose, and it's a good idea. I didn't learn how to decompose, which is another question. Okay. But as years went by, we keep on getting this problem. I keep on saying, we should do something next week, and they say, can't do anything next week, and say, yes, we can. No, you can't. Yes, we can. No, you can't. There's a song in South Pacific about that. But you don't even know what South Pacific is. It's an old film, 1950s. It's a musical. Anyway, or maybe that's Annie, Get Your Gun. Yes, I can. No, I can't. So finally they say, I have to say to them, I will prove it to you, since you cannot prove it to yourself. And so I take this problem that nobody can figure out how to decompose, and I do it, usually using less than 5 minutes to figure out at least one method of decomposition. And they say, oh, well, yes, we could do that if you put it that way. I said, why didn't you think about it? We just don't think about things like that. So I'm observing that people have not learned systematic decomposition of solutions and strategies. I'm sure you all know that a big thing should be decomposed into small things, but can you tell me the 21 principles of how to decompose? Or you didn't even know there were 21 principles.
Sure there are. I'll tell you where. Now, I told you already that Value Planning Book has all of this in depth, so that's fine. But let me go show you another way to just get it. We go to our website and we download another chapter from Guild Essentials. And it's this one, Evolutionary Project Management, which is the subject of my one-day course here tomorrow, about project management and my practical method. And then if in this chapter you put something like decom something or other like that, how to decompose, you get page 314, which has the 20 principles of decomposition spelled out explicitly. Yeah. No. Of course, you might like some more information on the meaning of each sentence, and of course, I usually write a page or two somewhere about it. But if you just want to know, what are the known methods of decomposing software systems and solutions so that you can deliver high value early? I'm telling you there's a body of knowledge. How did we get the knowledge? I spent 40 years doing it intuitively. And then one day I said, I keep on using the same principles. Why don't I write them down? Then I can teach them. Then you can learn them. Then you can have the power. See, I had magical power. I could decompose it. I would make bets, even today. I make bets with you today, tomorrow. I can decompose anything into stuff that can be done much more quickly, usually next week. Okay, and if you feel, no, it's not possible, Tom is wrong, then we make a bet. Let's see, how about $10,000 bet? Cash, foreign currency. I bet you haven't even got the courage to find the courage, put it on the table and say, I know I'm going to win. You know you're going to lose. By the way, even if I only won 99 out of 100 bets, I'm still well ahead. This is good betting odds. Okay, I have never been defeated yet, but you might defeat me today, and you can have $10,000. How's that for you? But you have to risk losing your $10,000. Put your money where your mouth is.
Cash or check with signature?
Yeah. I take credit cards.
But you will pay.
Cash.
You will pay with
cash? Oh, no, sorry, I have a small problem.
Sell your signature, I suppose.
Oh! Yeah. No, I can transfer $10,000 from my iPhone to your account on the day, no problem. But I want to see your ability to do it for sure. I'm not going to take a chance to get zero. That's bad betting. Okay. Now, most people chicken out and say, can we just do this for $1, Tom, and just for the game? Say, okay, we can do that too. Okay, so you think about it. But before you waste your time embarrassing yourself that I come up with such a simple solution that everybody feels they knew it and you look stupid, I would suggest you did a little study about decomposition and tried to solve the problem yourself. Again, this is just the summary of the methods, okay? But, and the Value Planning Book has 100 pages on decomposition with examples and case studies and details. Right? So why don't you do a little homework before you embarrass yourself and lose your $10,000 in public, right? I'm just, you know, and if you don't want to and you want to give me $10,000, I have all kinds of nice little charities like Mother Teresa and Department of Defense. And actually, when I was here last time, I did two courses and all the income we gave to the war widows of Ukraine. Those are nice charity. So that's where I'll get my $10,000 when I win it from you. Now, notice the first one. It
incredibly simple.
Most people, when they're confronted with a big strategy that will take 6 months, and I'm saying we should do some of it next week, they declare it cannot be decomposed. I mean, they're like you, experienced, intelligent, well-educated, confident, solve many problems. And they say, it cannot be decomposed, it will take 6 months. And I say, no. And they say, but I'm an expert, I've worked with this for years, it's my domain, and you don't know anything about it, Tom. I said, I don't care. I know how to decompose anything. You think it cannot be, I think you're wrong. Now, the first one says, if you give up in 5 minutes, you're never going to find a solution, right? What we found is you have to persist a little bit, more than 5 minutes, to find solutions to difficult problems. Surprise! How long time did Einstein use working on the general theory of relativity? Trick question. He died before he solved it, right? He just had the special theory. But he didn't give up in 5 minutes. He was very clear that you have to persist to find solutions to interesting problems. Thanks, Tom. Leonardo da Vinci was extremely clear about persisting in the face of obstacles. I'll get the quotations for it if you need it, but look up persistence, Leonardo da Vinci. He was fanatic in persisting. That's why he was greatest genius of all time and far more admired than even Einstein, turns out. My hero, Leo. Persistence. So it's not an accident that number one is hang in there, don't give up in 5 minutes. Don't be so arrogant. You think I'm arrogant? If you've probably thought that thought this morning, right? Arrogant, most arrogant son of a bitch I've ever heard in my life. One of my managers, in explaining me to another person, said, do not confuse arrogance with deep knowledge. And I leave it to you to figure out whether I'm arrogant or I have deep knowledge. Okay. But do not yourself be so arrogant. You say a problem cannot be solved because you cannot solve it in 5 minutes. Even Einstein and Leonardo da Vinci would take a little longer than you. You got it? Persist. There's a Danish philosopher called Piet Hein. He has a wonderful little cartoon and published in the Danish newspapers every week kind of thing. They're called Grooks. Anyway. Let's see if I get it right. I think I forget the word, but it's a problem worthy of attack will persist and fight back. Sort of. You get the idea. Problems worthy of attack will persist and fight back. Okay, but then they're worthy of attack because maybe you're the first guy in the world to solve. I have solved some problems that nobody has solved before. Simple one like, how do you measure portability? I solved it first, as far as we can determine. Huh? Looking back, it was very simple, but nobody had solved the problem. Great men had spent a whole conference of software engineering discussing it without even thinking they should quantify it, let alone doing it. Okay, and I beat them. Yeah. And it's a problem worthy of attack. How do you measure the portability of a software system? Isn't it? I mean, it's worth big money. It's, you know, everywhere, all the time. It's non-trivial to measure portability and find technical solutions for it. I'm making life difficult for this camera. Okay. Let's see. Okay, I'll leave that there. Then we need to make more progress. How to sustainably make strategies work? We say we've just tackled the first part. You have to get to the point where your estimates, and I haven't tackled the problem of how good are the estimates and what they're based on yet, but I can. Where the estimates tell you, you should be doing this now. Okay, then you do it. Now we're moving into implementation. We didn't plan, we're moving to do, right? In statistical process control. So you do it. Now, I believe doing things for a week is better than doing things for a year. Because if it doesn't work, you find out 51 weeks earlier. Okay? So it's a generally good idea to find out, to fail fast is the popular word that was floating around the conference.
I mean, if it's not going to work, find out early. Don't let 7 years go by, as the Norwegian health system did, and say, oh, it doesn't work. Because that's what they did. What did they do? They then fired the chief of all social security in Norway. Parliament fired him for not managing an IT project with Accenture as the salesman. But Accenture was laughing all the way to the bank. They collected all their money. Nobody suggested they should return the money. They're too stupid to ask for return of money. Too polite, these Norwegians. They didn't write a contract saying, if it doesn't work, we won't pay you. That's called a no cure, no pay contract. If you go to an interesting site, flexiblecontracts.com, you'll find a practical mechanism for agile contracting by value. My friends, Gabriella and Susan, built it on based on my methods. You might like to contract by value. It's agile. It says every new cycle, we agree on the value that will be delivered. You get a little value that will be delivered. Simple. We agree on the value that will be delivered. And we agree it will be delivered in a month or a week or something like that, time frame, short time frame. And we agree that if you deliver the value and we can measure it, we will pay you twice as much as we would pay for the labor. So you have 100% extra profit if you deliver the value. What happens if you don't deliver the value? Nothing. You don't get paid. Why should I pay for you writing code if you don't deliver the value? But of course, you already know that. I'm preaching to the convert. So, do you write all your contracts that way?
Yes.
Good. Do you always tell the truth?
No.
Now, so we got to the stage where we implement maybe a part of the strategy with two purposes at least. One, to actually deliver value for the joy of our clients and customers. Because that's a good thing to do. It makes us feel good. I did something useful. Every employee in the 10,000 person company in the US is saving 10 minutes every day from this week forever. Wow. You did something meaningful to humans. Okay. Not just Rick Wilson quote. Okay. And we do it with a view to collecting the money we get when we deliver value. And we do it with a view to learning if the solution actually works. And to what degree it really works. Maybe it wasn't 90%. Maybe it was only 65.2. Hurrah! I found a 65.2 solution, and I know it because I measured it. It's not necessarily sustainable. It's another problem. We'll get to it. Okay? But it is. And you can actually collect your money from the client at that point. If you save the 10 minutes that was the value we agreed at the beginning. So, and every cycle, let's say every week for 5 years, 250 cycles, you have a framework contract that says we will make a deal for delivery of value at a time and a cost, and if value is delivered, we pay. That's the flexible contracts contract. In my dreams, that's the only contract you ever write. And you can feel very proud of yourself. We only earn money if measurable value is really delivered to our clients and we can prove it. The other guys write code and 90% of all the projects are challenged and the value is not delivered. We are better than the other guys. Actually, that gives you a marketing competitive edge, doesn't it? I mean, if you're the salesman and you know all the other guys are saying, pay us for programming. What about value? We don't even know how to do it. You walk in and say, let's talk about your value, your numbers, and we only take payment when we have actually delivered you what your boss would think was a miracle, so you get promoted and get bonus. Which one did they choose? They'd have to be pretty stupid to choose the losers. Okay, so we have measured, so now we have the next problem, sustainability. Because tomorrow, you might, no, next week, you might add one more thing to do a little bit of work on security. And the user-friendliness you got the previous week is now destroyed. So simply adding things to your system threatens sustainability of any result you ever had. You got it? This is a law of nature and natural principle. Law of cooking and chemistry, if you like. I don't care what you call it. It was true 5,000 years ago, and it will be true in 5,000 years. We've been applying this test to everything I say. Found anything that will not be valid in 5,000 years yet? You think the Egyptians didn't have rather clear objectives for the sustainable performance of their pyramids? They're still there, thousands of years later. They're still wonders of the world. The paintings inside are still in full blazing color. That's not bad. I've seen it with my own eyes. Egyptians had long-term goals, like rest of the afterlife. Literally, they were very conscious of it. They didn't engineer for the moment. So, sustainability. Now, step one in sustainability. You have to regularly measure that what you have achieved is still there. That's true of anything, right? Like your weight, your health, to take simple examples, okay? Just because you weigh yourself today tells you nothing about your exact weight tomorrow. You want to maintain constant weight, you're going to have to keep on checking that you're still there. If it dives or goes up, you have to take action. Exactly the same mechanism. Okay, so step one in sustainability is you at least have to plan to measure and have a budget to measure regularly that the values are sustained. And you could even write a contract that has interesting variations. It says, we will pay you half if it works on the day, and we'll pay you the other half if it still works in 2 years. That will focus your mind on architecture that would be good in 2 years because it's worth a lot of money. Why not? In other words, motivation of the architect, designer, supplier to achieve long-term sustainability is a good strategy for ensuring long-term value, obviously. That's why we write contracts, they motivate people. Now, there's a third idea here. Some architectures naturally decay, and some architectures are naturally eternal. Let's see if I can think of an example. Okay. If I want to reduce weight, I'm an overweight woman, say, and I do liposuction. You know what that is?
Yes.
Yeah, right. Is this a short-term or long-term solution to the weight?
Short-term.
Very short-term. Okay. Now, are there any long-term solutions to the weight? Stop. Or longer-term?
Stop eating shit.
Stop eating shit. Absolutely correct. Plenty of evidence. Okay. So we have an architectural choice. Okay. So we've proven in simple terms, there are always short-term architectures that decay and longer-term architectures that remain by their nature. So the architect has to, if he wants, he says, oh, we only get paid in 2 years if we have long-term architecture, you have to hire smart architects who know the difference and pick the don't eat shit strategy. Don't you? If your architects are doing the picking, the client isn't doing it, they don't know enough to do it. They're hiring you to do it. That's your architectural, your solution provider competence. You have to pick the architecture that will not decay, that will be sustainable. And then you check that you were right in 2 years, every month. What if you thought you picked the architecture that would sustain, but you failed? You didn't eat shit, but you ate some other shit. It could happen. There are bad diets, okay? Well, then you should sense as soon as possible, like, not in 2 years' time, we failed, we don't get our 50%. What about every week, every month, keep measuring it? And if it turns out they're eating the wrong shit, then you'd say, stop, we are threatening our bonus. Root cause analysis, eating wrong shit. Cure, find right shit to eat. This is dynamic design to cost. In other words, dynamic means right in the middle of it all, you sense a problem, but you sense it early. That, by the way, is a lean principle. And you do something about it. So we now have plan, do, study, uh-oh, weight's going up, act, choose better shit. That's the Deming parameters. That's one of the most powerful ideas in the universe, the idea of feedback and learning. And I promise you, not just it will be a good idea in 5,000 years' time, let me try 5 million years' time, unless God intervenes and changes the universe. And that may be the most powerful thing I've ever learned, and the most powerful thing I can teach you. Learn fast. It is encapsulated in the fail fast idea in very simple terms, but it's a little bit more than just fail fast. Sounds like you must fail. You know, can I succeed? No, you must fail. It's a little bit too blunt, that fail fast. What about succeed fast as a paradigm? I just invented that. You can quote me.
We should tweet it.
Pardon?
We should tweet it.
Tweet it. Yeah, please.
Don't guilt Justin Bieber.
Okay, yeah. I really did. If somebody could Google it, succeed fast, somebody must have copied it, right? So, here. But I sincerely believe that succeed fast is a much better positive paradigm than fail fast. By the way, fail fast is just a subsidiary process to help you do that. It's not the primary idea. People don't want failure, they want success. And if you need a Twitter handle to have fun on bragging that you are on my course or something nice like that, I'm Tom Gill, we'll get you there. And that's good, because I might remember I said it someday, because now it's on Twitter, right? I say all kinds of strange things. Okay, so let's see. How to make... Okay, so I believe I have cracked the problem theoretically with a process. Okay? But let's reiterate. First, you need to define work. It works. In other words, the value. The level. You need to define when and where and other things. Okay, that's called requirements. Then you need to find stuff that fits those requirements, not just is generally good for some other requirements. You need to find fit for those requirements. Okay. Then you need to decompose what might be a big idea taking 1 year into smaller ideas that take a week. I call them 2% increments. So that you can try a little bit of this strategy with a few people, somewhere like in the Viv, and see if the thing works at all. But if it doesn't work the first week, and you try in US with a different part, and it doesn't work, how many times are you going to try parts of this strategy and it never works? Once? 10 times? 100 times? Remember what Al said. Repeating the same thing and expecting a different result is the definition of
madness.
Insanity, madness, exactly. Thanks, Al. At least that'd be fun, isn't it? He would enjoy my son's electrical bicycle. They're fun. Okay. Yeah. Okay, and then, so we need to deploy early, even partially. This is known in the science field as experimentation, and the business field, pilot studies. Okay, not a new idea. If it works, scale up, spread it to the world. If it doesn't work, find root cause, crack the problem, try again, until it works, then consider scaling up again. Okay, and then finally you achieve the value, first time, and now you have a sustainability problem. So if you were really, really good, when you found solutions, you had two solutions, right? Liposuction and right diet. Hopefully you chose the right diet. If you didn't, you're going to learn the hard way. There are two classes of architecture: sustainable architecture and non-sustainable architecture. Most people insist on learning from their own mistakes. That's where the fail fast comes from. I think personally that is not intelligent behavior. I think, and I practice all my life, learning from other people's mistakes. It's so much nicer. And there's so many people making mistakes, it's not difficult to find people making mistakes, right? Why do I have to fail? Okay? I do, I'm not perfect, rarely.
Right? Really?
Very rarely. No. But I generally succeed because I have learned from other people's mistakes. I think about it. Where did I fail? I did fail to set my own timer, and I failed by trusting you to tell me what to say. That's one of today's known failures by Gil. Now, I knew that I could only trust myself and my own alarms, but I didn't use the knowledge that I knew that I will fail if I do that. But I got reminded of it very quickly, about 10:42. How close are we to a break? It feels like break time, but let's see. It says here.
10 minutes more.
It's got to be break time. Okay. My alarm didn't go, but yeah, so 10 minutes break. Okay. Well, we have another hour. Wait a minute. We only answered one question in 3 hours. Are we making fast progress or slow progress?
At least we are making progress.
My purpose is not to teach you everything I know, because if you want to know that, you just have to read the book. My purpose is to get you interested in acquiring everything I know, perhaps by reading the book. So I hope some of you are feeling, I think I'd better read the book. Or come on the course tomorrow, or something like that. Okay, there's a lot to learn. By the way, I just happened to bump into this in the break. I mentioned Leonardo da Vinci, okay? And unrelenting quest for continuous learning. Persistence, persistence, persistence. And I hope you have it. I have that, you may have noticed. Best thing that can happen in my day is somebody teaches me something truly new and useful. But I have my own idea of what is new and useful. New means I don't know about it, and useful means I can use it. Okay, try if you can give me something. But people do all the time throughout the year. Okay, they recommend a book or a paper, or do you know about that or that. The more they get to know me, the more they realize how stupid I am and how little I know, so they help me. So that's good. So even Leonardo da Vinci didn't say, I'm a genius and I know everything. He said, I'm a genius, therefore I know I do not know everything. Therefore I will persist until I know more. And that's the genius. Okay, so we answered one question, but we had a many part answer. And in fact, the answer I gave covered everything I really wanted to do today, it turns out. So we're done, so now we have an extra optional hour.
Can we add questions?
Yes, but I don't necessarily claim we'll answer all of them. Do you have a question of are higher priority than any of the questions that are already written there? That you think maybe, we can vote on it. You know, we can have all number of questions that we all vote and see what people want to learn.
In case we are talking about the value and we want to define it, I want to go deeply and ask value for whom? Because when we say that we produce value, we should think about someone's needs.
Yes. Okay, so I'll put this question as value for whom?
And what needs we satisfy?
Well, and is another question. I like to keep things simple and then put it all together. That's called Cartesian synthesis at the end.
Can we? I insist on simple questions. So you if you say and, we can add five, but you've already had your say, and she had an idea before you said and. So what's your idea?
I don't think it's a question for such very important things. It's more about people who will be delivering that value, okay, and who need to believe that they deliver value. And they need to be set into the environment in which they can deliver value. Because I believe that even if we have quantified everything and we have the ideal formula, if people don't believe into that formula and people do not want or see no reason to do it, we proceed eating shit.
Okay. Now, I have another thing I like to do except for simple questions, and I like short ones.
Okay.
That was a long one. And sometimes long ones you lose track. So I tried to just capture the essence of what you said. People, faith, environment, deliver value seem to be key ideas.
Yes.
Okay, let's call that the short question without really working 20 minutes to reformulate it brilliantly.
Okay.
Then, in that order, Michael?
Generalized Lena question, I think that context of delivery value should be introduced during value definition, because it's really, we have some constraints and dependencies.
Yes.
It's about system thinking, or let me say holistic view.
Okay. Now, here, let me just put that seven, and constraints, dependencies, just to get some key words up there. Okay, I agree that is a separate but ultimately integrated with everything else question, and I agree it's very important. So I'll just put that up there for the moment. So you had a...
Before we go and implement the strategy,
yeah,
how do we set the right goals?
Okay.
Or how do we know we've set the right goals?
Okay, how, no, right, right, popular American RIT, it's a little easier, goals. Okay, very good question.
We assume that...
Sorry, I didn't catch the first two words, so now I'm tuning in now.
And we assume that our strategy was right.
We assume that our strategy...
was right.
Was right. Now, this is a question. Can we assume,
no,
or...
It's not a question. I'm arguing the eighth question, because we assume...
Oh, you're trying to answer this. Don't try it. No. I mean, I want to get to the stage where we have something to vote on, and we vote which one, and then maybe we're going to blow the whole hour on it, and this one won't be answered.
Okay.
But it's answered in the book. All questions are answered in my book. Actually, anybody know a man called Jeff Sutherland?
Yep.
Co-founder of Scrum, to give a little hint. Good friend of mine. So I was taking him around Oslo for a day as a tourist, and of course, little propaganda for my ideas. Okay. And we got to the Oslo Opera House, and he pulls out his iPhone and he starts downloading my competitive engineering book. And I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm downloading your book. I said, why are you downloading the book here at the Opera? He said, because you have convinced me that all useful knowledge in the universe is in that book. That's true story. Now, I don't claim all useful knowledge, but maybe, you know, 99%. Maybe I'm wrong. It would be a miracle if I had 1% of all useful knowledge.
About previous question about...
I don't want to start answering previous question. I want to get a brainstorming list. Then I want to make a choice. Then I will focus on the question. Can we do it?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So does anybody have a question they think might be more important and more useful to your colleagues than anything we have written up to now? Yes.
Efficiency.
Roma.
Efficiency.
Efficiency. Okay. Now, efficiency of what?
Efficiency of our approach following our strategy.
Okay.
Of measuring the efficiency. our approach following our strategy.
Okay. Our approach and something blah blah strategy, I didn't get the words in between. Our approach. Okay, no, this is, okay, this is arguably a higher level question than all of them. I understand that. I'm very, very interested in efficiency. Especially, I'm interested if you can define efficiency correctly, because so many people mix it up with effectiveness. Mm-hmm. Ah. So, just for fun, Roman, define efficiency correctly. Otherwise, I can't. If you have a different interpretation of mine, I don't understand what you said, right?
In simple words, efficiency, in my understanding, is the amount of efforts and resources we put into this, into the process of achieving this value. So, how much efforts and resources does this value consume to produce?
Okay. Efficiency is optimal, optimal balance.
Oh, careful, Michael. That depends on your resources, among other things. Here, let me just, I want to grab a file. Just for fun, show you my definition from what I call my language definition. So here I have my 700 concept glossary of terms, and what I want is efficiency. So there is effectiveness, right? And in simple terms, effectiveness is how good you are at doing something, hopefully with relation to something like your goal, as opposed to doing something good in general relation to nothing, which is stupid. Irrespective of the costs or resources. Efficiency is effectiveness divided by resources. You had it right enough for my purposes. Okay, let us take a look at that. Now, by the way, there are some so-called standard definitions, which, if I thought they were good, I would use them. So, I often violate the standard. And so, efficiency is effectiveness, which can have a very complicated definition, like the speed with which you reach your 10 critical factors in the contract is effectiveness. Sorry. The degree to which you reach your critical factors or goals in relation to any one or more critical resources you might like, time, people, money. So you could have efficiency, your resource relation can be multiple, three or four, money, time, people, space. And we do that, we track that in my methods. We track three or four resources. Actually, I need to get back to a nice little impact table. No, I do it okay. I'm going to grab the slides that I used at the talk. And show you a big static impact estimation table. Sorry, wrong thing. Oh, here's as good an example as any. So this is from my talk Saturday at the Lviv conference. It's also in my slides, guilt.com. Okay, so here we have a real impact estimation table. And real means it was used for real purposes at a real hospital to improve the delivery of pharmaceuticals to patients. And there's a case study giving it. And these are people, Malachi and Ravindra, are now doctoral students at an Irish university, and they are using my methods in connection with their doctoral thesis. But here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 values. In this table, they're represented by the tag, the name of it, and two pieces of information. How bad we are today, the time for process request, 70 minutes. How good we want to be in the future, 10 minutes. So they're going to get 7 times better processing requests. Remember, you're the patient if you're dying, and somebody says, you will die in 10 minutes if you don't get a medicine. They say, well, sorry, our present system takes 70 minutes, so you're going to die. Would you be interested in this value? This is what it's about. It's literally is medicines to sick patients in a real hospital. So that sounds like a good value. Now, what if they say, oh, we just made it on time, 10 seconds before you die. Here's the, oh, sorry, wrong medicine. That's the second one. You getting the idea? So they have found some critical values for the hospital process. They have defined scales of measure. I have great detail exactly what they did if you want it. Okay. And they said these are 4 critical values. They then have 1, 2, 3 major strategies. You see the names of them. You can guess roughly what they are. If it says automate, they're doing automation. If it says web, they're doing some web stuff. It doesn't matter what the details are. These are detailed. They then estimate that if we use the decision support strategy, we will get to less than 10 minutes, which is 90% of the way towards our goal. In other words, we'll move not 100% of the way down to 10 minutes, but this is less than 10 minutes. I'm not sure this is consistent, but they're saying we'll move 90% of the way towards the 10 minutes. Here's 70 minutes, here's 10 minutes, here is 90% of the way. And let's say they're down to about 15 minutes. A little bit of inconsistency with the numbers, I'm not quite sure what's not my worry. Okay. Now what that means is decision support is powerful for cracking this out, in theory. Okay, the estimate is good. They're doing other things, like they're adding up the percentage of the way towards the goal. This strategy will get us all the way to the goal, and independently of it, this strategy will also get us all the way, so we can choose one or the other and still get to our goal. This strategy, well, it's not evaluated, and I would put a 0 saying we think it's nothing, but they put blank. Blank could mean not evaluated, and it could mean it does nothing. I don't know. But anyway, if you add up these two, let's say what if we do both? Well, in theory, you get a much bigger number than 100%. Okay, but not if they collide with one another, thrashing. But it could be better than 200% if there's synergistic effects. And like cooking and chemistry, you don't know often until you do it. But I have this warm, comfortable feeling that even though I may be optimistic here and optimistic here, if I do both of them, I'm going to get pretty far towards my goal. And for the moment, I will say to myself, I have designed more than enough. Let's get into action and try these things in practice and see what happens. So what happens if you just put in automate rules and you get to your goal? Well, design logic says, if I get to my goal with that alone, I don't need that. Good thing I didn't spend any money building it. Good thing I got feedback early to know I didn't have to build it. How much do I save? Well, you save 25% of a 40,000 pound budget, which is 10,000 pounds, by not doing things which are not necessary for reaching the goal. This is called design logic. Now, my reason I pulled this up is, see down here it says benefit to cost ratio? You add up all the good things this does, 70%, 80%, 100%, you get 250. What is that? Well, it's a number that says how good we are overall for all our critical values. It's not a perfect number, and they don't really add up, but roughly they add up, okay? It would be hard to imagine if this is true and this is true and this is true, that you really only got 0.3%. So something's incredibly wrong in your thinking. It's got to be something like that order of magnitude, a hell of a lot of stuff. Okay? And, let's see, 250 to 90, 193. Which is the most effective strategy with respect to all my goals and values?
The second one.
Yeah. At least as far as we can evaluate at this point. So which strategy should I probably start doing next week, even if I have to subdivide it to do it things weekly? The second one. Now what if you decompose and subdivide it, all of them, this subdivided to 10 different things, this to 10 different things, this to 10 different things, and then you evaluated the subdivisions, and you found that in one of the subdivisions here, we got 100-to-1 ratio of benefit to cost, and nothing else near it. Then that's what you should do next week. And that's how we do it. This table allows you to reason about what should I do next week. That's called the prioritization question. What do we do first? Now, here they have two cost elements, money and time, not surprisingly. And here's the valuation. This will cost half the budget, this will cost half the time if we do it. That tells us several things. If we get lucky and we just want to achieve this, then if we do this, we will, and we're right, we get all of this, most of this, and most of this for half the price. That's a very efficient solution. It's not perfect. We have two of them we have not reached yet, but we have 50% more budget to do it. So now we say, aha, let's just say we really did use up 20,000 pounds in 3 months. Well, I have 20,000 more pounds in 3 months to crack the problem of getting 20% more there and set 30% more there, then I'm done. Reached all goals. Definition of done in Agile and Scrum is ridiculous. You know, I've written the code. Almost. Simple as that. I have a whole paper on definition of done, in which I give you a copy of. It's in agilerecord.com. It's on my website. And it says, you are done when you deliver to the customer's value goal. Doesn't matter whether you write any code or billions of lines of code. You are not done until customer gets value. Full stop. Anything else is ridiculous interpretation of the concept of done. Customer doesn't care how much code you complete, frankly. They want to be done from their point of view. Okay, so you're looking at a method called impact estimation, which I have invented, in case you wonder. And it took me 40 years. It's my life work. But where efficiency is defined as the set of these values over the set of constrained or limited resources. So now we have an operational definition which we can estimate and measure and make decisions like what should I do tomorrow. This is actually the fundamental tool in the EVO project management method that I will speak about tomorrow. It's a project management tool. So, Roman, we have now defined efficiency, and we got the question, efficiency of approach. So let me try, given this as background, let me try a quick answer. Our approaches are efficient enough if we reach our objectives within our constrained budgeted resources. But if somebody can find a method of doing the same thing with half of the resources, a new process, that would be twice as efficient a method, and we should adopt it. I now have answered your question.
I accept, sir.
Thank you. Well, save time on that then. But it's the big question, you know, how do we run an organization? What are we going to teach people? How can we allow them to optimize their own efficiency on the fly, week by week? And it turns out that tool allows you to do it, because this is not a one-time estimation. This is a tool we use every Agile feedback cycle, every bloody week.
So we are able to do dynamic design to cost. And I could call that dynamic agile delivery cycle optimization of efficiency. Or just efficiency for short. Right. Does anybody have a tenth question, which they would argue is much bigger and more important than, yes?
I want to add probably to Olaf's question, because all this information is about this strategy of doing things. What about the tactics? If the company, well, as far as I understand, it's like a snail. The head is already heading to the right direction, but there are the tails. So what about the people as an event? Inertia of the company.
Okay, so I captured three words: tactics, people, inertia. Characterizes the question, the area. I'll throw some quick answers at you. Years ago, I worked for International Computers Limited in London, now part of Fujitsu, but it was 26,000 people building computers in England. And they had a problem, Houston, okay. Now, Margaret Thatcher headhunted a young man called Rob Wilmot from Texas Instruments to save the company. And he did, and he used my methods to do it. And we saved the company, went into profit for the next 15 years. I have a case study on that in writing and slides, and you want to see the detail. But Rob Wilmot came from Texas Instruments. Now, they had a culture called, OST, objectives, strategies, maybe you can guess the third word. Yeah, that was the word. So they were, now I'll make a long story short. I analyzed this and I said, tactics are merely short-term strategies, but strategies and tactics are all means of achieving objectives. Therefore, we don't need the word or concept tactics at all, but we need to indicate the time frame on everything, and that serves the same purpose as understanding this is short term and this is long term. So in my planning language, you'll find that we are constantly setting short term and long term goals, and the short term goals may require what you would maybe say is a tactic, and the long term goals might require other things which you might consider a strategy. So as tactics, these are military terms, right? And tactics, you know, strategy means the more of a grand plan, and tactics are the battlefield right now today. Okay, so it's just short-term strategies and long-term strategies, another way of saying it. So that's my short answer to the tactics. I would merge, I convinced Wilmot to give up tactics totally and change his culture. Okay, he agreed with the idea. This is simplification. Why have two things? Why not just define, because you see, when exactly does a tactic become a strategy? At exactly what time? The answer is there is no definition, nobody knows, it's kind of intuitive. Okay? Now what I have is, I have things would have, let's say in one big plan, I might have in the next 10 years, 500 different deadlines, mini deadlines. Okay? And we could divide and say, anything this year, we're going to call a tactic. Anything after this year, we're going to call a strategy. Well, okay, have fun, but it doesn't change anything to classify that way. They are what they are with the time they are given. Okay, end of lecture on that. Hope you're looking at me like you almost thought this was fun. Yeah? Okay. Now, people, I spent 1 year on philosophy at university, then 2 years on sociology, then 1 year on psychology. Surprise, you maybe thought I studied engineering or something like that. I didn't because I couldn't, because the Norwegian engineering school is in a different town from my wife. It's about that simple, small country, okay? So I have studied a lot about people and I have continued to deal with them. So and you have this inertia to change, okay. So. Clearly, a very important central problem. Okay, you have some great ideas, but how do you get people to really reduce the corruption in Ukraine? And how many years is that going to take? And even the most uncorrupt countries in the world, like Norway, have degrees of corruption in high places. I used to think they were perfectly incorrupt Norway. We found it different later. You know, it's just well hidden. Okay.
But we have maybe 1% corruption and you have 95%. That's the difference. So how now, maybe if we go back before my time in Norway in 1900, maybe it was 50 to 90% corruption, just for fun. And maybe it took them almost 100 years to get down to 1%. And zero is probably unattainable in a real world of greedy people. Okay. So, the problem of reducing corruption, which some politicians and other idealists have obviously wanted to tackle and publicly say so, is I was talking to a guy at the conference, and he said, well, you know, we had two revolutions and nothing's changed. I said, actually, change takes a long time because of inertia, no matter what. Okay, and we're talking just in IT cultures, it takes 10 to 20 years. Nations take hundreds of years. Read history. I read a lot of history. Okay? So I'm sorry, but revolutions don't happen this year. Doesn't matter how many people get shot in Maidan. Praise the martyrs, but it's going to take a long time. But the only thing that helps you change is persistent hard work like Leonardo da Vinci. You just have to start beating away at the problem. And I look at Norway, which has almost attained perfection status as a nation. Look, United Nations quality of life survey for 200 countries on many factors, Norway 1, 2, or 3 every year. Happiness index. Norway's never first, always Denmark, because they're drunk when they do the survey. But they're so happy about their beer. Now, this is the only country where everybody has beer at lunch. You know, Norwegians do beer at lunch. So I'm thinking, okay. Now, so Norway's only 2 or 3 in happy. And wealth? Well, you guess where Norway is, right up there. So, Norway has achieved happiness, quality of life, and wealth simultaneously. But it didn't happen overnight. This hard work by idealists, starting, for example, the socialists and communists, believe it or not, in the 1920s, working for a better future. Okay? The socialists got rid of the communists, smart move. Didn't end up with Soviet Nordic countries or something like that. They perceived this communist to be very dangerous people. Okay? Although my mother was a communist all her life, but I knew she was an idealist. See? She really did believe that there was something better out there. It was called communism. Actually, I have to tell the story. When my mother died, she had about 5 years ago. She's in an old age home. She has 3 statues next to her bedside. Lenin, Marx, and Stalin.
Stalin.
She is the only communist left in Great Britain. It's my mother. Yeah? And I said, Mother, I understand when you were young, idealist, and Uncle Joe hid his evil deeds from the West so he could recruit agents from the Americans, and you got fooled. But surely now we know how evil Stalin was. I mean, directly evil. Like, oh, let's see, let's kill a few thousand people in the party in Kiev. How evil can you get? I mean, killing your enemies, but killing your friends must be a deeper evil. Okay, he was a very evil man. It's very clear now. Mao was the same, and Hitler was the same. Mao did different things. He didn't kill all the communists. He starved them. He made them starve so he could give money to other nations to buy weapons to make himself look good. How evil can you get? You starve your own people. But Mao did it. Nice little Chairman Mao. A nice little guy. Yeah. On and on and on. Okay. And I asked my mother, Mother, surely you know that these are no ideals to hold, these people. And her only answer was, because she was the last true communist in Britain, yes, maybe, but we didn't know it then. True story. Oh, I don't know where I got there, but I thought I would tell the story for fun, so. Inertia. Okay. Now, so how long time did it take from we believe that communism is a good idea, let's form the Soviet Union, to 90% gone. You only have Putin left. I'm not kidding. Okay? And the answer was 80 years or something like that, right? So, some of you will live another 80 years. And you will be 90% through your program of making a better nation. And I'd like to help you.
And the only way I can help you is to give you tools of thinking about problems like how do we get rid of corruption for real, in spite of inertia. Yeah? And that's what I'm offering you. Okay? Some of you will use it in computers, but you will discover the same tools can be used in politics. I made a very concrete offer to one of your founders yesterday to do exactly that. I want to be on the team, and I think I have acceptance. And I'm just offering the ideas so you can continue the revolution in a more systematic, efficient way. It'd be a shame if it took 200 years when we could do it in 80 years. Your lifetime for your grandchildren. I have 5 grandchildren. But, you know, I hope Norway doesn't get totally corrupted by all the Syrians that are going to come in. You know, I mean, I nothing against Syrians, but I don't really want them to mess up a good Norwegian culture, because they will. They're the ones who kill their daughters because of honor. I'm sorry, but they do it in Norway already. You know, we don't need people like that in our culture. Norwegians don't kill their daughters because they're marrying the wrong guy. But some people do. And they do it in Norway. That's the strange thing. So, yeah. Oh, how did we get to such a serious subject? Somebody tell a joke. Tell a joke. Well, but it's inertia, okay? So, now here, let's take another thing. When I was 1960, I did my first agile project. I decomposed a project of installing IBM systems into 20 small evolutionary steps, and I delivered them one at a time and accumulated. I had invented what we call agile without knowing it. We didn't use that name. I just said step by step deliver value or something like that. And then I grew older and got to conferences and talked with people, and I discovered nobody was doing that. Everybody was doing waterfall Big Bang. They even thought that's a really good idea to do Big Bang. It was very popular fashion to do waterfall, I tell you, 1970s or something. And so I would hold talks at conferences and you should do small steps at a time. Get some feedback, measure it. Yeah? But it wasn't until, let's say, 40 years later that my sons, the writers of the Agile Manifesto, managed to popularize the idea. So it became everybody's doing Agile. I have had to wait 45 years to see such a simple idea realized on a mass base. And even now they're doing it badly because they don't do value. But at least I got them doing things in small steps. You see? Yeah. So I'm an old man, so I have learned that an idea which you're all alone about and feel is hopeless can come to fruition in your lifetime if you live long enough and if the idea is good enough, meaning people really do need it. Okay, at some point, it will take off. Okay, and maybe you get rid of corruption. But you have to be patient. And so you also have to be happy for small improvements. You know, little bit less corruption there, little bit less corruption there, prevent corruption growing in a new place. You just have to attack it on all fronts, you know. And there might come a little, you know, like what is now a minority political party. In Norway, we have the Greens. They suddenly got control of coalitions. They were nothing before. But they're actually in Norway and several other countries. Suddenly, the Greens are suddenly gaining traction. So minorities, at some point, you actually are in control of the government and can, you don't have all power then, but you have more to do things. So you have to wait for things like that. So, you know, grow the idealist parties. And it can take many years before they get enough support to actually get power. And that's the way democracy works. It's slow, but what Churchill said about democracy was, you know, it's a terrible system, but it's better than the other ones. Messy system, but better than dictatorship, 95% corruption with oligarchs and other things like that. I hope I don't get on a hit list of some oligarchs by speaking like I am. Don't show this film to any oligarchs. They might feel I'm saying dangerous things. Okay, I will sacrifice my life for you. Hey, I'm practically at the end of my life. It's not a big sacrifice. If I could make all corruption go away in Ukraine tomorrow, I will accept the penalty to die instantly. What a great sacrifice. You make a little statue of me in all the towns, you know, the guy who gave his life for ending corruption. We know some people have to give their lives in this country. I came from a culture like that, the revolutionary America, you know, gave our lives to get rid of the stupid English king. It took a long time, and it's not exactly a perfect culture yet, and there's plenty of corruption in America, in case you didn't know. Okay, plenty of oligarchies. By the way, I moved from America to Norway and never ever thought of going back. You got to be kidding. You know, this idea of the American dream, you got to be kidding. It's not a good place. On these rankings of quality of life, it's like 27. The only problem is Ukraine is about 78 on the list. That might look good with your eyes, but not with Norwegian eyes. Welcome to Norway. I just learned from the Kiev News or something like that, that there is a Ukrainian-Norwegian group that meets and tries to cooperate. Huh? How do I join?
The Norwegian partners.
Okay, so maybe that's enough. Now, we obviously have to make some choices. So I want you to, I'll just review these, and then I'm going to ask you to vote. And if any one of these gets a hell of a lot of votes, we'll use the rest of the time on it, which is 24 minutes. Okay? So, how to measure, how to predict or estimate, how to define, for whom is the value? This is the answer is the stakeholders. People, faith, environment, delivery of value. Constraints and dependencies, knowing what the right goals actually are, and let's say we did these two sort of. So, everybody has one vote. How many vote for number one? No, we didn't. How many vote for number two? How many vote for number three? Two. How many vote for number four? Three. How many vote for number five? How many vote for number six? Woo! How many vote for number seven? How many vote for number eight? How many vote for number... No, we didn't. Okay. So six is the winner. By democratic vote, we decide we're going to look at people, faith, environment, delivery, and balance. Okay. So let's maybe get a formulation here. Okay. Eight. And... being red, green, colorblind, I can't see what I'm writing for that, so different. That's it. Okay. People, faith, it's in ourselves, I put in us there. People, faith, something in values. Okay.
Environment.
Okay. Environment and value was the key words. Okay. So let me try a formulation. How can we get faith, in spite of the fact we have our people and their people and inertia, that in the environment we're working we can deliver value? Sort of like that. That deserves a drink of water. There are two kinds of faith. There's young, innocent, optimistic faith. I will meet my prince. He will make life wonderful forever. And then there is faith based on experience. I've had three husbands and they're all terrible. Okay. So my point is this. Faith can be based on little or nothing, and even be wrongly based on false ideas. But faith can be based on experience, knowledge, and evidence, and the faith can sort of guide you in the right direction. If I always use method X 10 times, and all of my projects are successful, then I have faith that if I use method X, my next project will be successful. I might be wrong, but I have faith based on evidence. Okay, so we need to bring in the concept of evidence-based faith. Actually, there's a management thing, you can Google it, evidence-based decision making. Okay. And that's where I am. I believe that people have a right to an opinion, but there are two classes of opinions. Opinions based on evidence, and opinions not based on evidence. The opinions not based on evidence might be right, but they're probably not. Opinions based on evidence might be wrong, but they're more likely to be more right. Okay, so you are safer with evidence-based thinking, right? Okay. Now, let me then bring this in. Okay. Would somebody just tell me some method that they believe in other words, they have faith in? Name something. Some method that maybe everybody's heard a little bit about. Name your favorite method that you have faith in for IT. Yeah. You believe in nothing? You just. What? Results. Okay. Okay. So beliefs. Okay. Results. Okay. Any other belief ideas you believe in?
Earned value management.
Okay. A little note there, I have a good friend in America who tracks the US Department of Defense earned value management methods and writes books on it. I can introduce you, you can get his newsletter. But my reading is that the ideal is fine, but the government institutions corrupt it totally to the point where earned value means spent money, not earned value. So I have no faith in that method in large bureaucracy. Now, if it really were value actually earned, real value, and meant it, yes, right? The problem is the ideal sounds great, so they even make laws about it in the United States. You will do military projects with earned value. Men. But the moment the Accentures of the world get a hold of it, they corrupt it. So it's, yeah, the more money we spend, the more value is earned for us, but don't tell anybody. It's totally corrupted. So I have lost faith in that one, but in reality, but that's because of evidence says it doesn't seem to work very well, even in the largest environment doing it. But just a little note on the way. Anybody else have another one?
Oh, fail fast.
Fail fast. Any others?
Force field analysis.
Have you been reading my book? I'm a serious question. At the very least, I'm going to have to tell a story about it. Okay, story time. Go away. Let's see. I'm just putting a force field, okay, so. I'm just wondering whether this is the same thing or different. But is the fundamental invention of Nikola Tesla, which he is calling rotating field discovery, feeling that they might be related, but okay. But if nothing else, I will tell this story anyway. Okay. But I need a better definition of force field analysis. But about a month ago, my youngest son was reviewing my book with me, and I have a way of reviewing my book with even my grandchildren of 10 years old. I show them the over 100 quotations from Elon Musk, Leonardo da Vinci, and I ask them if they can interpret the meaning of the quotations. And it's quite amazing what my 9-year-old son of my son does. He actually gets it. I don't know how I can do it. Anyway, so I was showing it to my youngest son, and he says, Dad, just show me a quote by Tesla. Now he knows how fanatic I am about Tesla and these things. Right? And I said, oh, sure. And I put in Tesla, and I get Elon Musk quotes, but I don't get Nikola Tesla quotes. I forgot. And I said, that is a serious omission. So I started looking for quotes. Now, I have a part of the book where I explain why I'm writing the book. And I've already hinted at you about 5,000 years ago it has to be good, and 5,000 years from now it must be good, right? So I'm saying, I don't care what anybody thinks about my book at the moment, not even you. I mean, it'd be nice if you like it, but if you hate it, I don't care. As long as I'm right in 5,000 years. I'm serious. I've just decided that's my perspective. But it turns out Nikola Tesla had the same perspective. Look at that quote. He's discovered this thing called rotating field discovery, which enables alternating current and these things. And he went head to head with no less than Edison about DC, AC. Edison was wrong about transmission of electricity. Not bad to beat Edison, but Tesla did it. And almost got destroyed because Edison was more powerful and better businessman, a few little tricks like that. And Tesla was just a geek. Okay. But he makes this incredible statement that I would not give up my rotating field discovery for 1,000 inventions. 1,000 years hence. Oh, we didn't have to wait so long, did we? The telephone, remember that thing with the line going into our house and we lifted it off and said, it's for you, dear? Gone, essentially. And the picture camera, gone. It's in here, it's in the phone. They're already gone. But what people knew as telephone and picture. The functions are there. We transmit voice, we capture picture. But the telephone, as we knew it in my time, and the camera are gone. Dead meat. But he said, even if they die 1,000 years hence, my idea of rotating field discovery will still be valid and powerful. And that's, I wouldn't trade that for all the silly inventions in the world. I wouldn't even trade it for an iPhone, he said. Maybe. Yeah. But, so that's my attitude. And it's what I want to give to you. I would like to give you things that will not be obsolete in your professional lifetime so you look silly following a bad old religion by faith. You know, like Scrum or Lean. That you have principles and methods that allow you to tackle changing technology and changing Ukraine. Changing in 10 to 20 years like we cannot imagine. You only have to go back in your own short lifetime, 10, 20 years, and then go forward again and you see changes you probably could not have imagined. Okay? Yeah. So the point is we have to have tools that enable us to deal with change which we cannot imagine. Or if we can imagine, we cannot believe it will really happen. Short story about the end of the Soviet Union. You ready for it? You want a story about the end of the Soviet Union? You remember? Okay. So I was in Berlin the night the wall fell. By accident.
The wall fell?
The wall fell, yeah. The Berlin Wall. Opened. Overnight. Nobody saw it coming.
If you asked anybody, they would say maybe 10, 20, 30 years, maybe, probably not. But it fell overnight suddenly, okay? And I had a simultaneous interpreter at a conference I was working at, a lady, and she told me the following story the next day. In the middle of the night, she got rung up by CNN, the news agency, and said, can you get the mayor of Berlin on the line? We need to interview him. And she said, why? She's in Berlin where the wall is falling, and CNN knows it's falling before anybody in Berlin seems to know. That's amazing, okay? So she had her connection. She tried out, got the mayor from Berlin, and got interviewed on CNN. But and then woke up and mayor, the wall is falling. No, wall falling. No. Nobody in Berlin was expecting that. That's how sudden and change. And of course, it's big change. I mean, you know, otherwise Angela Merkel wouldn't be chancellor. She'd still be in East Germany somewhere. Okay? So, yeah, kind of fun. And I had a little bit of fun. I tried to chip away at the wall symbolically. It was really hard concrete. It was really difficult to get even a little piece of it, but I managed. I think somebody else did it with a big pickaxe. Yeah. But that was amazing. That reminded me of how suddenly things can happen, you know? What if you have a peaceful demonstration in Maidan and suddenly 100 people are killed by snipers? Can you imagine that? Okay, so the point is this. Sudden, dramatic things will happen in technology. iPhone can be a nice little symbol of that. Okay, and the internet, another great symbol of that, you know. I mean, I had no idea in 1980 there was ever going to be a thing called the internet that could do what it does. No, and I'm a very imaginative guy. I wrote about the future all the time. I could imagine little microcomputers, masses of them in cars, and I wrote papers on it 10, 20 years before it happened. I was very foreseeing. I did not understand the internet. I did not understand I had access to the world's largest library instantaneously on my phone in my pocket, or my Apple Watch, okay? Hey Siri, show me a picture of Brad Pitt. Who's that? Who could have imagined you could get Brad Pitt on your telephone box? Okay, but the critical idea is I'm out of this world, sir, right? But you look younger, okay? You need tools to cope with shocking unknown futures in your life, your country, and your professional life. And I'm trying to give them to you. I've handed over my book. It's all there. But you're not going to be instant expert because you sat through the day, okay? But if you want to be an expert, you will study hard and practice hard and learn. I have to do it, so you have to do it. There's no shortcut, okay? It looks simple. Well, maybe it looks complex first time you look at it, but actually it's incredibly simple. In fact, let me show you how simple it all is. Tell us a story about implicit. I'm just doing a little bit of that there. But let's see, go to the beginning of the book. Here's the story of the book. Last summer, I said, I'm going to write my management book for managers, top managers. Well, all my other books are for IT people and engineers. So I wrote a 600-page book. I sent it to my friend Mary Poppendyke in Minnesota, and said, Mary, what do you think of my great new book? She's a fan, she likes my methods. She's the lean lady, in case you don't know who Mary is. And her reaction is fairly blunt, as she can be sometimes, but why I value her opinion. They said, Tom, it's 600 pages, and nobody wants a long book. They don't have time to read it anymore. You know, this is the internet age of attention spans of 3 seconds. Now, I didn't directly say to her, I don't care if anybody wants to read my book this century. But it has to be written down so it's available for whoever wants to read it in 1,000 years. That's really literally what I'm doing. I mean, it's nice if you want it now, but if you don't, it's okay. If nobody ever wants it in the next 5,000 years, I failed. I screwed up.
But if I become world famous like Leonardo da Vinci in 5,000 years, my dead soul will be dancing on its grave. Imagine that. You think Leonardo knew how famous he would be on the internet then? No way. No. Okay, so then I did a little trick. I had this 500-page book of 10 chapters and 10 subjects, and I had a little appendix at the end, a paper I'd written called Value Engineering, which is how top managers can convert their corporate visions into numeric values. And I moved it to the front of the book in 20 minutes, and I said, this is the book, the other 500 pages are the appendix. I sent it back to Mary, I said, short book. This is architecture at its finest. This is designed to constraints. But then I thought, that's a good trick, that'll do it. But then I realized, still not enough, because some people don't have the attention span of a soundbite, like politicians and the voting public. Fight corruption now. That's it. It's a message. Vote for me. Soundbite. But gets on television, you know? Then, you know, if you're like Castro or somebody like that, you hold 5-hour speeches and nobody stops you. You're the dictator. Okay. Yeah. But in a democracy, even Churchill had to be brief, you know? Never before in the history of man have so many owed so much to so few. It took him 3 or 4 days to do that little sentence. We will fight them on the beaches. Speak about Nazis now. Fight them on the shores. We will never give in. We will never surrender. Took him another 5 days. Very short, but I saw Churchill once. I've seen a lot of people in my life. But I went to visit the House of Commons about 1957. There he was, buttering around the back with Churchill himself. So actually once in 57, I went to Beograd, where I started learning Serbian for fun. And I saw on one day in one place, Marshal Tito and Ho Chi Minh in the same car parading around. Good tourist sight for the day. Anyway, so this summer I decided to crack the problem of very impatient managers. So I said, okay, I believe very strongly that if you are an expert in any subject, you can condense all essential things into one page. That's a little trick I learned from Bill and Dave. Who's that? Bill and Dave, what are their last names? Hewlett Packard. Mm-hmm. Very smart guys, built a great engineering company. Not least great because all the engineers could decide what to do and were not told top down by management to do it. They're one of the biggest adopters of my methods because the engineers could choose and not the managers. One guy at Hewlett Packard said to me one day, Tom, you know what's wrong with this company? What's wrong with him? He was an older guy, my age. He said, it's all the young kids that have all the real power here. I said, that's not an accident. That is a design. So I write one day, but I decided to get even more radical. I wrote, as you see, the soundbite. Deliver real value now. I have now summarized everything in the book. That's it. It's about delivery, we're going to talk about next week. Real, like it really happens with your client. Value means what they think is value, not your code. Now means next week, not next year. I'm so proud of that. I'm only thinking of one little modification like deliver real stakeholder value now. It's implied, but a lot of people don't understand the difference between a user and a stakeholder. And if we had enough time, which we certainly don't,
five.
Number 5 is all about stakeholders. The broader category of the 50 critical things like the European law is a stakeholder. And you can't interview them as a business analyst and say, what do you want? But if you fail to do law and you photograph a German house as Google has done, you can be thrown out of the market or fined billions. It's as bad as a Volkswagen example, okay? So for Google and Microsoft have failed to consider the stakeholder European Union at the cost of hundreds of millions of dollars in legal fees and fines. Okay, so the short half minute thing is you need to bring in the stakeholder concept more deeply, as good systems engineers in space and military always do, but as practically no programmers do. Programmers are still user friendly, maybe customer. Two of 48 stakeholder types. They're missing 48 critical stakeholders. Therefore, our IT projects fail all the time. Failure means not satisfying a critical stakeholder.
So, So then having only four words and a whole page budget, the dynamic design your boss says, okay, I'll give you a whole sentence about the book in case you have time to read that. Oh gosh, more space, dynamic decision. Okay, I'll give you the five line summary, quarter paragraph. Oh gosh, I've still got more space. I better fill it out with something. This is my little joke. But maybe you can encourage yourself to try the first page, the whole page, imagine that. And then if you like it, recommend another way to read the book, just read the quotes. Just read Leonardo, Elon Musk, Nikola Tesla. There are over 100. Don't do anything else. Get the wisdom from other people. Forget Tom Gill. He is just like Newton, standing on the shoulders of giants. And you can stand on my shoulders, if you like. That's reading my book is what that is. Okay, thanks very much. We're done. On time.